Announced the death of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II.
Well, well, welly, well, 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 I'm live. How you doing? What's going on? Hey! It's good to see everyone. Welcome to Thursday. Normally this would be the last stream of the week, and it is. Because I have had a funny all week, and that's the end of that. How are we all doing? It's good to see you. It's good to see you. What you been up to? We got Steph. How you doing? We got Just Johnny. We got Overzealous Euthanasius. We got Blue Vixen. We got Goblin Hugger. Please go show some love to Goblin Hugger. That's the wrong command. There you go, Gobs. Yeah. amazing streamer. Did I miss anyone out? No, I think we got everybody. I'm pretty sure we got everyone. Crystal's there in the chat, hiding away. Did they discontinue Party Parrot on Twitch? What's that about? That's one of the best emotes. Why did they do that? Why did they do that, chat? What's going on there? It's the parrot going like that. Why did they do that? What's wrong with it? Hey, Ellie, how's it going? Good to see you. It's late in the day, chat, so you'll be joining me with my daily treat. Yeah? And today, I am eating these little fuckers. Now, I don't know about you, but every time Easter comes around, right? This is a British thing. I don't know if they do them in the US. Every time Easter comes around, these fuckers are just out in the shops, and they're like £3.80. So it's like cheap enough to justify it, but at the same time, not expensive enough. No, the other way around. It's just a tad more expensive than you'd want to do it, but they're really nice and they're addictive. Anyway. Real Anne, how are you doing? Good to see you. What the fuck? Why have you got Party Parrot? Oh, that's Pea Parrot. That's Pea Parrot. It's a different one. So you can still get it. You just have to go. I'm going to have to go to that person's channel. BTTV channel right there. Hey, Mr. Dank, how you doing? So anyway, these come around. These come around. And they're these little bastards. I'm sorry they're not vegan. I'm really not doing well with trying to be vegan at the minute. Much worse than I was doing before, which is saying something. Because I wasn't doing so well before anyway. So. Chat's too good to be true. It should be illegal. You should ban these. Shouldn't be allowed. Let's be honest, it's not when Easter comes around, they appear in the shops, it's straight after Christmas officially ends. Yeah, that's true. It's pretty much at the end of January. And they're just like, here's these bastards. You're gonna buy them because they're nice. And they're full of shit. The shit that makes you just want to keep eating them. Hey, Great Crab, how are you doing? Woodbug, what's up? Good to see you. Happy Thursday. How are we all doing today, chat? So I've been addicted to this game called They Are Billions. Anyone played it? Have I been talking? Did I talk about this yesterday? Basically, it's kind of been my depression game, right? So I've just been playing this They Are Billions. It's basically like tower defense, loads of zombies, literally billions of zombies. It's really hard. It's kind of like a roguelike, but not really. It's not really a roguelike. I don't think it really counts to call it a roguelike. It's a strategy game. Top-down, RTS, all that stuff. You know? Good to see you back. Good to see you back in the chat. Still sick, but better. Making some tofu and fried rice for comfort food. That sounds really nice, Blue Vixen. Get it down you. So yeah, I've been playing They Are Billions. And today, I finally got to the point where I feel like I had like a full proper game, because the way that this game works is you get like 120 or 150 in-game days to build up your defenses, build your colony, right? And basically you have to take over the entire fucking map. Otherwise, when it comes to the final day and you have a big final horde, you just get fucked. You just get completely fucked over. So I got to a point where I was on 120 days, which is like normal difficulty. And what was the other bit? What are the other parameters? Low zombie population. So a low zombie population, right? Accessible, they called it. They call it in that game. And what else? It's like another thing. Oh, it's the environment that you're in. So there's this map called the Caustic Lands, and it's the most difficult one. So I finally got to the point where, on that, with all those difficulty parameters, I finally had a really good game. Like, I felt like I fucking nailed it. And it was really, 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 really good. So I'm hoping to uninstall that now and move on. You know, when you play a game for just so much and you're like, right, I'm fucking done with it now. It's time to come out of this and start living like a person again. But I know I'm just going to play it again tomorrow. I know I am. I should really just finish Scorn. And you know, I should do that on a private live stream for the patrons. Because that's how I started streaming it. But I should just finish. I should just finish Scorn. What else we got in the chat? It's wise to have depression, escape entertainment. Yeah, it was pretty good. It's served me pretty well, not gonna lie. My fire alarm is singing the song of its people because I have the audacity to turn the air fryer on, and I can't take it off or turn it off either. Oh, fucking hell, Blue. That sucks. Being a person is overrated, to be honest. I agree. No. That game is Stardew Valley for me. Yeah, Stardew Valley is another really easy one to get lost in. Harvest Moon as well, the original Harvest Moon. Harvest Moon 64. I've got a real hankering to play Blast Corps 64. Well, it's not called Blast Corps 64, is it? It's just called Blast Corps. I want to play some Blast Corps after that game last night. If anyone saw the final game of Trash Bingus last night, you'll know what I'm on about. But finally watched as well last night after the stream, the Borg episode. I don't think it's the last that we ever see of the Borg. Spoilers in case anyone's not seen this 30 odd year old TV show Star Trek The Next Generation. But it is just so funny. It is genuinely so funny. Like I'm in like season four of this really, really highly rated show. It won Emmys and all that kind of stuff. I'm halfway through it. You know, it's from the 80s, and I'm enjoying it. I think it's good, yeah? Best of both worlds. Yeah, best of both worlds. I've seen both of those. Like the clip, the season end cliffhanger, and then the conclusion at the start of season four. And I'm a little bit into, he's just been to see his brother back on Earth, and they had a fight in the mud, and he cries. Anyway, what was it? Where was I up to? Oh, yeah, so just find it so funny. I'm fucking like basically halfway through, or more than halfway through, this old sci-fi show that it's really, really good, but you know, it's critically acclaimed. But like every I can't escape the feeling that pretty much every single one of the other storylines in the episode is like, this is it, it's over for Starfleet, done. The humans are done. Humanity is completely done, facing like a massive genocide, the likes of which we've never seen before. There's no way out of it. It's completely impossible. But then Data just does something on a computer and everything's fine. Great. Fucking excellent TV. Fucking excellent TV. Honestly, chat, that's what the entire show feels like. Like, it's like the worst. Like, what's that one episode where it's like everything's fucked and it's gonna... There's like a specific one where I think like nanites get released by accident because Wes Crusher is doing an experiment and he creates some nanites and the whole ship's going to fuck and it's gonna like take apart all of the ship piece by piece and it's just everything's fucked. And then Data's just like, oh, don't worry, Captain. I've devised this program which will completely just eradicate the nanites. And Picard's just like, make it so. And that's it. It's just done. Wesley leaving the show is for the better. Yeah, I heard he leaves the show in the fourth season. He's just a silly Billy. He's a kid on a spaceship. What could go wrong? Children on a spaceship, what could go wrong? Like, a lot of the things that happen on the ship are to do with kids as well. Like, a lot of the problems. Like, there's that episode, I think in season 2 or season 1, where all the kids get kidnapped. You've got to remember that there were like 5 or 6 months between part 1 and 2 of Best of Both Worlds. No way, I didn't know that. I did not know that. That's crazy. Never trust the kids. You can't have the kids be on a spaceship. Serious spaceship adventures. You just can't. And like, there was another episode I was watching last night in season 4 where there's like a kid. One of the kids on the Enterprise like plays a prank on another kid and nearly kills him, like, and the entire mission is waylaid because this kid is fucking dying because this other idiot kid like spilt like a disease on him or something, and he's like mental. The episode where Q introduces the Enterprise to the Borg initially is quite good, I feel. I really enjoyed how they brought Q round. Because at the start, I was like, yo, listen. I genuinely hate this character. As soon as Q comes up, he literally comes up in the first episode, and it's like, aha, I'm this all-powerful being, and I'm going to judge humanity, and I'm completely insufferable in every way. Right? And... oh, you mean 6 months of broadcast time? Because I thought you meant like 6 months in between the timeline in the show, between part 1 and part 2 of Best of Both Worlds. No, that was confusing. Okay, so you mean like the show? Yeah, everybody would have been on a cliffhanger. That would have been crazy. Anyway, what was I talking about? I was talking about Q. Completely insufferable piece of shit. Oh my God, what is going on? I hate him. I don't want him to come back. I know he's going to come back because he's like an all-powerful god being or whatever. And then the way that they bring his arc around, where he's like, actually, humanity needs to know if they're dipping their toe into the universe, there's all sorts of shit that they're just not prepared for, and the Borg is one of them, and it's like, oh, that's amazing. That was really good, and it was really scary. But actually, do you know what? Like, the way that that arc goes, that they get, like, attacked by the Borg after, like, a year... and they've had like a year to prepare. It feels really shit that like at the end, it is just another example of Data doing something on a computer and then everything's fine. That's literally what happens. Like I remember, I was sat there watching it last night and I was thinking, right, okay, he's tapping into Picard's connection with the Borg and they're gonna learn something. They're gonna figure out how to like communicate with them and establish something. But the Borg just self-destructs for like no reason. No reason. They're just like, right, self-destructs, boom, and they're gone. And I know they're probably gonna come back. It's just like, what the fuck? I honestly don't mind. No, I hated it. It should have been way more than that. This dungeon sub boss, how are you doing? Welcome in. Liz, how are you? Welcome in. How are you doing? Vaughn, did I say hi to you, by the way? I've been chatting to you, but hello. Hope you're having a good day. Where am I up to? Technically, they're explorers, so they shouldn't have reasons not to have kids on a spaceship. Honestly, I figured a lot of the kids were just the crews. Oh, no, yeah, they're the crew's kids on the spaceship. Yeah, for sure. But it just seems very dangerous, doesn't it? Anyway, never mind. Sisko knew how to deal with Q. Is Sisko the other member of the Q collective? What's the continuum that takes his powers away and makes him a human? That was a really good episode as well when they make him a person. And he's just like, I'm mortal! And he's like, in pain. Oh, it's so good, man. That shit goes so hard. And he learns a lesson, doesn't he, as a character art. Oh, Deep Space Nine. Right, okay, so I'm gonna be... okay. I'm going to be learning about Sisko in Deep Space Nine. Does he claim that Trump will save America or say Frazzle Drip on occasion? Oh, you're on about QAnon. No, this is Q from Star Trek. Hey, Solar Juice, how are you doing? I first hated Q because I feared there'd be too much Q magic happening, but it turned out fine. Yeah, well, you know, I think that, like, if you're gonna, it's big ideas sci-fi, isn't it? Like, Gene Roddenberry, like, really obviously, like, tried very hard to think about all the different possible things that there could be in space. And all the other writers on the show were probably like, yeah, there's gonna be, like, god things, things that we don't understand, alien species that are just, like, gaseous and all this kind of stuff. That's cool. And it inspired, like, a lot of sci-fi, you know. Like, when you watch a lot of TNG, it's just kind of like, oh, Justin Roiland just, like, watched The Next Generation and just, like, tried to make it weird and about a granddad that does a load of drugs. And that's Rick and Morty, right? He just, like, mishmashed Star Trek The Next Generation and Back to the Future, right? My parents were too low income and unsophisticated to watch anything like Star Trek. Well, you say that, but I know a lot of people who watch Star Trek who weren't particularly wealthy growing up back in the day. You don't have to be sophisticated. Sophisticated. What a nonsense concept. Sophistication is irrelevant. You will comply. It's kind of one of... The Borg are really interesting, aren't they? Because it's like, what if collectivism just went insane? Right? And I think that's a really cool... I think it's a really cool concept. It was probably inspired by some kind of McCarthyist idea of communism, right? It was probably some, like, idea of, like... Oh, the Russians, they just want to make everyone look the same and act the same, and everybody earns the same money, and that's communism. That's it probably came from some kind of thing like that, right? But really what the Borg do is fascism. They, like, assimilate all cultures and you know, and all that kind of stuff, right? Hey, Mia Byte, how's it going? It's good to see you. Welcome in, everybody. Please go follow Mia. She's incredible. How are you doing, friend? What's up, comrade? Yeah, the Borg are colonizers. Yeah, they're absolutely colonizers. But they don't get it. They don't get it. Hey, Middle-earth Marxist, how's it going? Welcome in. My dad watched the original series as it first started airing in 1967. That's really fucking interesting. I don't know if my mum or dad watched Star Trek, the original series. I think my dad might have. But he was dead poor. Like, he was so poor that he just didn't have, like, a telly in his gaff. So, you know. Family visiting, so I'm all right. Could drop at any moment, though. Yo, no worries at all. I know what that's like. I know what that's like. It's all good. Appreciate you being here. Actually, the Klingons were the Russians in the original series. Yeah, but that's so dumb because they're just not... They're not even remotely close to, like, even what Russians were thought of back then. Like, what all about honor and shit like that? No, surely the Klingons... No, because I always thought that the Klingons were, like, a very sort of, like, racist, orientalist idea of East Asia. Like, East Asian culture. Because they even got, like, the fucking racist mustache, you know? That's gotta be what, like, and communism obviously is, like, what people were thinking of China back in the day. So I don't know if it was that. The original series Klingons were quite different from the Next Generation and beyond. Oh, okay, fair enough. Yeah, because in the Next Generation they're all about honor, innit? And Worf's been dishonored. My dad watched Star Trek, and the concept of space socialism went completely over his conservative head. Well, they don't outright say it because there's all these glaring errors in it. Do you know what I mean? It's not very good socialism if it's supposed to be space socialism, because they're talking about, like, you know, Picard's there and he's like, we've eliminated want and need. Everybody gets everything that they need. We're a species focused on collective self-determination and autonomy. And then they're talking about, like, paying for drinks. There's always these bits in the scripts where they're like, are you buying dinner? Why would you have to buy dinner in a world like that? What are you on about? It doesn't make sense, does it? Nonsense. A late introduction. One of their friends loved it. My parents are very incurious people. I did assume some of it might have been partly due or not. Not enough of any disposable income. Yeah, fair enough. Whatever. Your dad's like, keep politics out of my sci-fi show. Yeah, that's going to work, right? That's going to work. Thank you for the follow. Hexies, welcome to the stream. How are you doing? I was so disappointed watching Star Trek when the Klingons didn't hug anyone, and the rare times they did, they let go pretty quickly. Didn't Klingon at all. Good joke. Cool. Good one. Good one, Mia. Everyone clap. The honor stuff later came after the original series. So what... Okay, well, maybe I'll have to watch the original series then. I'm going to have to watch it, aren't I? I'm just genuinely going to have to watch it. They're more sinister and deceitful. Sinister Kitten! With the £15! Holy fucking shit. Everybody, please, go and follow Sadistic Kitten. I'm going to fucking spell your name wrong. Is that the right one? Fuck! You literally just donated and I got your name wrong. Yo, hold up. Hold up. Thank you so much for subbing off Twitch. Thank you so much for supporting the stream. Everybody, please, while I just just give me a bit while I just copy him. She's there! I can do the tab thing. Everybody, please go follow Sadistic Kitten. She's amazing. Please go and show her some love. Excellent streamer. How are you doing? It's great to see you. The Klingon Corps gave Jardia... We're talking about Star Trek, by the way. If you've just come in, we're talking about Star Trek. Because I started watching The Next Generation, and I'm like... Where has this been my whole life? You know? Where has this been my whole life? Sadistic Kitten, thank you so much for subbing. Thank you so much for subbing off Twitch and supporting the stream. And thank you so much for subbing as well. Oh my god, thank you so much. Incredible. Absolutely incredible moves. Thank you so much for supporting the stream. Thank you. Confero, how's it going? Welcome in. Good to see you. How are you doing, Sadistic Kitten? Long time no see, long time no chat. If you want to do a Let's Talk About Star Trek stream, I'm here for it. I could talk probably for quite a while. I'll tell you what will happen. I'll tell you what we'll do. When I'm done with The Next Generation, because I am going to watch all of it. I didn't skip any of the episodes of Season 1, by the way. I watched them all. Even the bad ones, right? No, I did skip the racist one. Like, the one that's just fucking so fucking absurdly racist. What's it called? Honor or something? Honor Kill? By your honor? Stupid. Where the aliens are just like black African people. Code of Honor, that's the one. Yeah, so like, skip that one, but then like, I watched all of them. So when I'm done with it, we'll chat proper about Star Trek, because I'm all for it. I mean, I'm happy to still talk about it now anyway, because everyone seems to be really enjoying it. Where have I... This was what was missing from my streams, like me watching Star Trek, TNG specifically. What the fuck? You've never heard of that? Oh no, yeah, Code of Honor is the worst. This is the worst episode. It's just really bad. It's just really, really bad. Obviously, there's a lot of alien races in Star Trek: The Next Generation, in the Star Trek universe, but like this one that they come across, they're just black people, and it's like, come on, man. This is fucking stupid. And they're just like absurdly patriarchal. Yeah, just not. It's just not good. It's just genuinely not good. Never got into Star Trek. I have no idea what goes on. It's really, really good. It's really, really good. Apart from that one episode there. And I have been talking about some of my criticisms of it. A few criticisms of it. Beard looks immaculate, by the way. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Had it trimmed on Friday. You're the first person to say that, by the way. I even had a date on Friday, and she didn't even fucking mention it, even though she'd seen me previously when it was longer and more untamed, and I was even stressing about it. I was like, oh, I'm sorry, my beard looks like shit today. And then I turned up on the date. She didn't even fucking say anything about it. That's bullshit. How did it go? Oh, it's all right. Yeah, it's fine. not really looking for anything serious at the moment. So as far as that goes, yeah, all right. Fine, okay. I'm looking forward to just doing a lot of like solo polyamory at the minute, to be honest. So yeah. Your beard always looks great, hun. That's what I want to hear. Mia knows what's up. Give her a round of applause. But maybe I don't pay enough attention to facial hair. Okay. Anyway. I watched Dune 2 and I enjoyed it. I've still not seen Dune 2 Hyper Dune. Still not seen it. I'm going to find it hard to go and see it, to be honest. I'm going to find it hard because Dune Part 1, Denis Villeneuve, Dune Part 1, I didn't get too excited about it, you know? It's just whatever. You got Timothy Chalamet, he's a little guy and he's all mad and he's got that face, hasn't he? Kira was talking about him, how twinky he is. Just like a hyper twink, isn't he? And, you know. That's that. But on top of that, he's just a little guy, isn't he? You've got, who else? All the Skarsgårds are in it, aren't they? You've got Bill Skarsgård and another Skarsgård, and they're all the Harkonnens, aren't they? Because they've got weird faces. So that's that. But, you know... There's only... Listen, how can you... There's only one Dune for me, chat. Yeah? There's only one Dune for me. How do I find, like, that best scene? Dune 1984 best scene. There's only one Dune for me, chat. Where is it? Fuck! How does it not know what I want? I'm just typing in, like, I'm furiously typing in shit to try and find. Baron Harkonnen flying around! Baron Harkonnen flying around and Sting... Oh, here we go. This is it. This is it. I found it. 2 minutes of Dune, and it's the best fucking thing ever. Chat, this is easily the best version of Dune, and you can't tell me otherwise. What's going on? Is it muted? Why is it muted? Okay, there we go. Oh, it's so good, chat. It's easily this is just the best thing in the world. What's happening? This is cinema. This is fucking cinema.
I place you in charge of Arrakis. It's yours to squeeze, as I promised. I want you to squeeze.
Zach, what's going on? Everybody go follow Zach.
Give me spice! Drive them into utter submission. Do not show the slightest pity or mercy. Never stop. Go. Go! Show no mercy!
Get back!
Here comes the best bit, chat. Fade. Lovely fade.
Fade. And when we've crushed these people enough, I'll send you, Fade.
Yeah, kind of looking like Rocky. There you go. There you go, chat. That's the only Dune for me. That's literally the only Dune for me. Zach, welcome to the stream. How are you doing, pal? Everybody go follow Zach. He's a great streamer. I was watching a bit of your stream yesterday. Or the day before. I can't remember. How are you doing today, man? How many Skarsgårds are there? I thought there was only two. There's loads. There's like three. There's like three or four. I missed loads in the chat. Sorry. Just give me a hot minute. You notice beard hair all the time because you have a habit of running your fingers through it. Makes sense. Makes sense. Can't unsee Wonka looking at him now. Oh yeah, Timothée Chalamet's Willy Wonka, isn't he? Willy Wonka in the past. That's to explain Dune 1 to my mother-in-law because she didn't get it. Really just did not understand that Dune is about the thinly veiled cultural issues of the time. Yeah. Polygonal fighting. Yeah, that's the best bit, Mia. What are you on about? Patrick Stewart's in that as well, isn't he? He's Gurney Halleck. That's why it's so good. Well, you'll be the best fighter in all Arrakis. Oh, what does he say? The Empire? Us Atreides. Did you know that David Lynch's original cut of Dune was 3 hours long and they eviscerated it? They absolutely fucking eviscerated it. And with that in mind, it makes sense, really, as to why... as to why he reacts like this when producers say that his scenes... When producers say that his scenes are too long. This is really loud. I have to turn this down.
If you want to cut the time down, I'll
tell you. What is this with everybody?
No.
What is it? Really? I'm serious. Fucking A, man. It drives me nuts. Fucking shit how long a scene is.
I fucking love him. He's the best. He's the best. I'd do anything for an hour with that man. Genuinely. Just an hour. Just sit down and have a nice coffee. Just. So, you could learn so much. You could just learn so much. I watched an edit of Dune 1984 that had Don't Stand So Close To Me playing in the background whenever Sting was on screen. No, that's ruining art! What are you doing? So yeah, it was, David Lynch wrote and directed Dune, 1984. Not the recent one. No, that's Denis Villeneuve. And I don't know who wrote it, but Denis Villeneuve directed the recent ones. Excuse me. Aren't they making a Dune MMORPG? They've been making Dune everything. I bet there's Dune action figures. Sting looking like best timeline. Best timeline Rick Mail. Buff drop dead Fred. Imagine. Yeah, oh my god. Good god. Who cares how long it is? Fucking A. David Lynch getting mad is just like the funniest shit ever. Like, what are you gonna do, little man? Like, what are you gonna do? Paint me a picture? I thought you mentioned the book. No, the book was written by a guy called Frank Herbert, who loved cocaine and Islam in equal amounts, maybe. So yeah, there you go. Imagine trying to make a Lynch movie more incomprehensible. The hubris, yeah. Yeah. I wish I had the confidence to have that reaction when people tell me what to do. Well, that is literally like fucking 60 or maybe, no. When did he start making films? He started making films when he was like 30, when he was like my age. So this is like 30 plus years of studio numpties, producers telling him that his like movies are too weird, they're too long, and he just wants to make his weird little art. He doesn't give a fuck about what they say. You know? Anyway, so there you go. Chat, we got a crazy wild stream for you today, even though I started really late, so I hope I'm going to be able to get through the most of it. The most of it. We're going to go through a bunch of Twitter garbage for the first bit. And then we got some video essays to watch. We got a Jack Saint video. He's talking about AI documentaries, AI Twilight documentary. And we got Noah Samson's video that I was supposed to watch from 2 weeks ago. Supposed to watch that last week, but of course I wasn't live. And then if we've got time, we'll hit up the Cavernacle with some of his thoughts on James Summerton. So there you go. Jack Saint be praised, yeah. All hail, Jack Saint. But just before we get started, I would like to remind everybody that this stream is my job. It's my full-time income, and I had 2 weeks off, and I don't get sick pay. And really, all I need to get to the goal that I need to get to is to raise about £50 per stream. And we already hit £15 thanks to Sadistic Kitten jumping in straight away. Whoa! Wait, is that right? Wait, did I get another dono? When did that happen? Johnny, what the fuck? When did I get a £25 dono? What the fuck, Johnny? Johnny! I just looked at the dono bar and it was like 40 quid, what the fuck, from before the stream started. Johnny, thank you so much for summing up Twitch. Thank you so much for supporting the stream. Let's hear it for Johnny, everyone. Hey, Val, how are you doing? Good to see you. So, yeah, we're basically only £10 away. Yeah? It's not two terms of service, I hope. The terms of service being a literal person. Oh, yeah, no, I can't watch that, can I? Oh, no, you're right. You're right. Hey, Dave, what's up? Welcome in. Yeah, so we're not going to be watching Noah's new video. Yeah, we're not going to be doing that. Jesus Christ. 17 minutes ago, got a follow, so thank you for the follow. What else did I miss? No, that's it. Okay, cool. I got a follow last night after the raid. That's normal. All right, cool. So, yeah. I just need £10 more tonight. Sadistic Kitten with the £10! Holy fucking shit! She did it. And chat, you know what that means? I like to encourage people to sub off Twitch. Thank you so much, Sadistic Kitten. Really appreciate that. Thank you so much for subbing off Twitch and supporting the stream. Hit the daily dono goal! I like to encourage people to sub off Twitch, and so that means that we will also be doing an unofficial hype train. And what that means is that basically we have to say bye to the VOD watchers. See you in a bit. And I was muted that whole time. But it's good because I didn't say anything too important. Thank you so much, everybody, for donating, getting us to the dono goal for today. Really, really, really appreciate you. Thank you. And that was Gloria Estefan with Dr. B quality. Quality 80s music video there. Yeah, I'm gonna have to get like another one up and ready just in case we get more donos today. But honestly, relax. You don't have to donate any more today. We hit the goal for the day. It's all good. Thank you so much, everybody. It also means that we're halfway to the halfway goal, which means that as soon as we hit that 300, that 300 will be unlocking double feature movie night. So, bear that in mind. Your YouTube stream got ganked. Not sure if you'll see this. Oh, yeah. I see it. Okay, let me just type in the YouTube chat so that everybody knows. Just chill for a hot minute. It will come back. Yeah, it really doesn't like it when I play music videos over on the YouTube side of things. So that'll come back in like a minute or two. They're pretty on point with their fucking You know, that's the whole reason I like lose the VOD watchers. Like, I stopped the stream recording, and in case you're wondering what that meant when I said we gotta lose the VOD watchers. Because when I upload the VOD to YouTube, it'll just get fucking destroyed. If I have anything like that, like a music video from Vivo on there. Anyway. Alright, so let's get started. Chat, get yourselves in your hazmats, because we are entering into the politics zone. Yeah, you're gonna see some bad takes in here. It's not gonna be good. But here we fucking go. We got some Twitter news garbage. But the first thing that I want to talk to you about is actually quite good. So we got some incredible stuff going down. So if anyone heard of the cartoonist, quote-unquote cartoonist, StoneToss, just absolutely vile, absolutely fucking vile fascist cartoons, complete dog shit. Someone basically identified him. So finally, we know the person behind StoneToss. And what's the funny thing about this? Well, he looks like Reddit personified, doesn't he? He actually just looks like every Reddit commenter that you could imagine in your mind smushed into one, doesn't he? So there you go. That's what he looks like. But anyway, what he looks like is not important. What is important is just how harmful he is and the things that he spreads. The fascist rhetoric that he spreads. So, Alejandro Brujo, how are you doing? Welcome in. So, StoneToss tossed Hans Kristien Graebner of Spring, Texas. Comics and cartoons can be used to entertain, educate, and enlighten. In the case of the right-wing webcomic creator StoneToss and his eponymous cartoon, they can also be used to spread racism, anti-Semitism, xenophobia, and anti-LGBTQ plus bigotry. Since 2017, StoneToss has been doing just that. Has an exceedingly wide presence among neo-Nazis and white nationalists. The easy-to-digest 3 or 4 panel comics are accessible vectors for spreading far-right wing hate, and as we will show, real-world violence. Even before StoneToss began its regular program of hateful propaganda, the creator did much the same under the name Red Panels. While many have noticed the stylistic and thematic resemblance between StoneToss and Red Panels, people have debated whether or not the two webcomics could be attributed to the same creator. In this report, we aim to settle this debate and give the creator an opportunity to explain his views under his real identity, Hans Kristien Graebner. So, it's kind of like his display picture over there. The earliest StoneToss cartoon captured on the Internet Archive on July 30th, 2017 was titled Foreign Food, a criticism of immigration and multiculturalism, depicting two diners at a Chinese restaurant and a Spanish-speaking chef. A bigoted view, for sure, but relatively mild. A later cartoon was far darker, titled Friendly Fire. It mocked the issue of suicide among trans persons. So, yeah, let's just add that real quick to the content warnings. I didn't know we would be hitting that shit hard. Hold up. Transphobia. Transphobia. I spelled it there. There we go. All right. Just reading up on the George Takei JK BS today. Wait. What? He said something. George Takei said something to JK Rowling? Hit me up with that in the chat, Mia, if you got a link. Let me know if you got a link. And we'll have a look at that. It mocked the issue of suicide among trans persons. Yeah, that's fucked. We're not gonna take a look at that. So anyone unfamiliar, like Ben Garrison, these comics would read like satire, but they are 100% serious. No, they are serious, these ones, yeah. They are. There you go, Mia. Hit me with it. It's from yesterday. Yeah, I saw that J.K. Rowling was doing Oh, I don't know why that second. Why did that second one? Does it only work for one link? Well, I got the second link anyway. Thanks, Mia. I got you. Yeah, I knew that J.K. Rowling did Holocaust revisionism. Thread on the persistent claims about trans people and the Nazis. The LGBTQ plus lobby are just dismissed. Sorry, just dismissed. If you say LGBTQ plus lobby, I don't care what else you have to say at all. So yeah, she was basically saying that like the Nazis didn't set fire to the books at the Institute for Sexual Wissenschaft at the Germany back in the day. So he replied to her, did he? Is that what happened? The Malcolm Clark tweet was particularly vile. Yeah, I'm not about to read that shit. She got dogpiled as well. George got involved. When Hitler rose to power as German Chancellor in 1933, he enacted policies to rid the country of Lebensunwerts Leben, or lives unworthy of living. His targets included Jews, Roma people, disabled people, communists, but specifically homosexuals and transsexuals. While many are familiar with haunting images of the first book burnings in Germany, which took place in May 1933, most aren't fully aware of their origin story. They were from the library of the Institute for Sexual Research, founded by Magnus Hirschfeld, a gay Jewish doctor. Yeah, that's right. That's where the whole anti-Semitic shit, conspiracy bullshit that's also transphobic comes from. When people claim that there's an LGBTQ plus lobby, it's all blood libel, standard stuff that the Nazis basically said, like gay Jewish communists are making people trans, and they're just doing the same thing again. They're just doing the same thing again nowadays. We are luckily like armed with knowledge against this stuff. So you know, I guess George Takei was like trying to get onto J.K. Rowling here to try and fucking like tell her the actual truth about what's going down, but she's not interested. Like, the thing is this is a great ratio, do you know what I mean? And he's right, and it's good that someone like George Takei is like, you know, popping off against someone like J.K. Rowling, but there's absolutely no point in replying to J.K. Rowling. Like, she is so far gone. I was actually gonna address this like very, very briefly earlier, but I guess I will. Let me just go into my bookmarks, wherever they are. Do they disappear when I zoom in? I gotta zoom out and get my bookmarks back. There we go. So I got a bunch of stuff to talk about here, but I was gonna reference this tweet from Katie, because Katie's pretty smart. She says, it's pretty clear now that J.K. Rowling has lost her mind, so can you all stop posting at her as if she needs to just see that she's harming people and will come around? She's been the same level of extremist as any of the other big-name transphobes since 2019. She's right. She's right and she should say it, chat. She's right and she should say it. So, you know, if you want to know my opinion on all that nonsense, yeah, J.K. Rowling's a Nazi. She has been for a long time. She's an extremely rich billionaire, piece of shit transphobe. We should all just do our best to, like, forget she exists, but also try and resist any of the actual harm that is being attempted to be done to trans people collectively and mutually by organizing together. And that's how we destroy fascism. But fair play to George, okay? You know, I'm not about to say fuck off George or anything like that. He's all right. He's all right. He does his best. I think he does his best being the age that he is and having the politics that he does have. Because he's like a pretty solid like vote blue no matter who kind of guy, right? I think that's why I unfollowed him, because he's got some pretty he's got some like pretty annoying pro-capitalist sentiments, and it's just annoying, right? People still say, show me where JK was transphobic, which is a trick question because they deny that transphobia exists. Yeah, I mean, you know, I just think the only thing to do about that is just to block people. As soon as people say that, just like, fuck them off. It's just a waste of time, do you know what I mean? It's gonna upset, like, it upsets me, do you know what I mean? It upsets me when I see that, and I just fucking block him, because there's no point. You're not going to get through to anyone on social media, and just fucking block him. That's the best thing you can do. And we just have to organize locally and globally in a way against this fascism, you know? That's the only way that we can do it. Full blue MAGA, that's why this feels refreshing. Yeah, no, you can have some good takes. Like, here's the thing, right? Like, George Takei strikes me as like a similar person to my mum, who is like socially progressive but economically conservative, which is a bit of a, you know, it doesn't really make sense. But on social issues, she's pretty progressive. Like, she believes trans women are women, and she hates transphobia. She hates racism, all that kind of stuff. She just doesn't see how, like, economic policy from conservatives will actually, like, result in worse material conditions for marginalized people. But anyway, that's... she's not gonna learn that. She's fucking nearly 60, you know? So... I think George Takei is just kind of like that, you know? I think he's just kind of like that, but a bit more, I guess, in denial about it. Because when you're a blue MAGA, you think that, oh, actually, I'm progressive. I'm progressive for being so insane about Joe Biden. Anyway, let's get back to this StoneToss shit. Though the rounded, friendly-looking figures presented a light-hearted feel, the message is far more dangerous. Racial superiority, anti-Semitism, Holocaust denial, Islamophobia, homophobia, and transphobia. These are themes that are consistent through the StoneToss oeuvre. To counter claims of being a Nazi, StoneToss provided a glib denial on the About page of his website, writing, "No, I am not a member of the National Socialist German Workers' Party, a National Socialist, or a fascist. I just enjoy edgy humor." One thing that you'll know, chat, one thing that you'll realize about fascists is that they are so ashamed to be fascists because they know it's bad, actually, right? But commies, we're proud, aren't we? We're fucking proud of it, comrades. I'll never, in a million years, deny who I am. But these fucking losers... these fucking losers at every fucking turn, they'll be like, "No, I'm not a Nazi, I'm not. Just own it, bro. Just fucking own it. Stop being such a fucking coward about it. Anyway. I just enjoy edgy humor. Redditors and other brainlets like to pretend otherwise, however. A later capture of the same page presented a more wordy defense of his work. "Surprisingly, I'm not actually a 90-year-old member of the National Socialist German Workers' Party. Additionally, I'm not a National Socialist, Fascist, Alt-Right, or any kind of supremacist. My crime may be worse, however. I make transgressive art. In my defense, the cartooning is a long transition of slaying society's sacred cows. It practices predates the United States itself." I knew he was going to bring up Charlie Hebdo. I knew he was going to bring up Charlie Hebdo. I think I might have read this before somewhere. But yeah, I knew he was going to bring up Charlie Hebdo, and it's like, bro, shut the fuck up. What Charlie Hebdo did was fucking well offensive, man. So fucking annoying, dude. "My work is similar to those often featured by Charlie Hebdo, published by the New York Times, and shown on Family Guy, all famous non-Nazis." I mean, that's not true. That's not true, is it? Right? Oh, Jesus Christ. "I've also featured works from other artists, including multiple artists of color." Oh, dude. Fuck off, man. Fuck the fuck off. "This Dungeon sub boss says, I'm an anarchist, but got to admit, the Soviets had a damn good anthem." Yeah, I'm an anarchist as well, This Dungeon sub boss. I'm an anarchist communist. They're quite... it's quite similar ideologies, you know? Obviously, the USSR anthem is just a bit, you know, not an authoritarian. But I'm also of the belief that the USSR is, like, definitely not as bad as America made it out to be. I've been learning a lot of stuff. A lot of fucking stuff about it, you know? Anyway. "Libs deny being communist because they aren't. Then the right sees it as the same thing as them hiding their fascism." Right, yeah. For sure, that's true. That's true. When he says of color, he means white, because that's also a color. You know what? You're probably right, Mr. Denk. "The sacred cows, like American exceptionalism, borders, the founding fathers. What sacred cow is he aiming at?" Yeah, none of them, actually. None of them. make a very hypocritical Nazi indeed. Despite this, some would claim my most controversial and successful cartoon is an example of historical denialism. I invite you to read it yourself. Of course, a reasonable mind would like to see that it is a critique of so-called free thinkers hysterically trying to shut thinking down.
What are you on about, dude? It's so funny. Like, when you realize that this is just a guy, right? It makes it all the more funnier.
I encourage you to enjoy the comic, but if it offends you, that's okay too. Right, well, why are you so bothered, bro?
The Stone Toss doth protest too much, methinks. Racism, anti-Semitism, bigotry. If it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, well, you know the rest. He may argue against being a card-carrying Nazi of 1938-1945, but that's why we have the term neo-Nazi. That's true. That's true. What was he thinking? Thought he was being clever, didn't he? Little dickhead. As with anything, we have to look through the words and pictures to the message being delivered, and in StoneToss's case, no one is buying his argument. StoneToss is already a steady stream of white nationalism, neo-Nazi ideology, and bigotry. It takes only a smattering of samples to see what StoneToss is all about. Oh, Jesus fucking Christ. I don't know if I can show this. Let me just look at this real quick. It's so intense, dude. Okay, I'll show you the ones that I can show you. The other ones that I couldn't show you because I just think it's too fucking offensive. Do you know what I mean? I don't want to show that shit on my stream. It was like basically saying that, like, George Floyd killed himself. I think everybody's probably seen that one. And the anti-Semitic one was like trying to say that, like, Jewish rabbis were drinking the blood or like sucking babies' circumcised penises and shit like that. I know this motherfucker from some old, not current art friends being strangely into him. Yeah, it's not good. Not good. Remember the last time I read one of this guy's articles, I was physically gagging. Hey, Kaelin.com. Well, he doesn't write articles, does he? Do you mean the person who wrote this article, or do you mean StoneToss? You mean, like, read one of his panels? So this is nonsense. Ancient anti-Semitism. Yeah, that's right, yeah. Nonsense here about, like, Confederate flag and Pride flag. I got you. Don't shoot. I'm a Nazi too. Prove it. There are two genders. What? Some of it just doesn't even make sense. What is going on? StoneToss often mentions the topic of circumcision. This is weird. This one's really fucking weird. I've not seen this one. Is this a hospital where they do genital surgery on kids? Only circumcisions. Oh. And then, like, this person walks out? Wait, what? What? What does that mean? Presenting more examples here will be superfluous. At the time of writing, there are 597 cartoons on the StoneToss website. Red Panels. Red Panels was an earlier cartoon that shared StoneToss style and themes. Its last cartoon, titled Hot Metal, was published on February 27th, 2017, a few months before StoneToss appeared. This cartoon, which was a riff on a scene from the 1991 movie Terminator 2, was a farewell of sorts and depicted a Terminator signaling his goodbye before being lowered into a molten metal and given a Nazi salute. I've seen that one. It was accompanied by a farewell message from the creator. Jim Davis got real quiet when StoneToss released that. Wait, what? What do you mean? After 18 wonderful months as the creator of Red Panels, I am announcing my retirement. Knowing and interacting with you has made all the labor worthwhile. My decision is motivated by a bright future. The meme president has ascended to the throne. Brexit has shaken the foundations of the EU. No way did he say this. This is great. This is great. and everywhere you look, there is new skepticism of mainstream media. The tide of the culture war shifts. In the midst of all this good fortune, I am taking the opportunity to rest. Red Panels has been the most fun project I've ever undertaken, though it is not the only one I plan to. Producing free comics for you has been immensely rewarding, but future endeavors require the funds that a proper career would provide. As such, I'm focusing my time accordingly. Red Panels gets super racist. Okay. Is this guy's pinned tweet still a trans suicide joke? Yeah, I mean, he likes to do that a lot, so probably. Probably. This cartoon with an explicitly Nazi message was removed from the existing website, but the original's been preserved here for viewing. Wait, what? Oh, it's there. Oh, okay, it's that, that hot metal thing. It's on the web archive. Okay, I was wondering what that meant. Yeah, it's just this one. It's him, the creator, getting lowered into a, like the end of Terminator 2, getting lowered into molten metal and then doing a Roman salute instead of doing the thumbs up that Arnie does in that one. Okay. So, oh shit. Red Panels is about to get insane. Many on the internet have noticed the stylistic resemblance between StoneToss and Red Panels in art, kind of humor, and themes, as well as StoneToss' timely appearance as a replacement for Red Panels. Nevertheless, StoneToss has consistently denied that he was the creator of Red Panels. Let me just see what these ones are saying. Yeah, I might not even be able to show that on Twitch, you know. Okay, that's like a shit one about Kink of Pride. Lube, I have diet. Okay, this one. This one is so funny, dude. If there's one thing, yeah, one thing about StoneToss that always used to make me laugh, it's like his misunderstanding of gay sex. Well, not gay sex, anal sex. Specifically, just anal sex in general, right? Because here, you've got like a gay couple. You can tell that they're gay because they have a pride flag in their bedroom. This is so rare, by the way. It's just so rare, right? So fucking rare that actually I've been in someone's bedroom and they have a fucking pride flag in the bedroom. Just insane. But also, you can tell that they're gay because one has pink hair and one has green hair, right? My man says, we're out of lube. The other one says, I have diarrhea. It's like, dude, okay, right. So, you know, wow, you're mature enough to know that, like, there is some poo involved if you end up maybe having anal sex. Oh, whoa, whoa, oh my god, whoa, there might be poo involved if you go in someone's butt. Oh, whoa, what the fuck? Anyway, right. But it's so dumb, right? It's so fucking stupid. It's like, yeah, of course, like, if you're gonna do anal sex, like, anyone knows that you have to, like, clean your asshole and shit like that. But this guy's obsessed with the idea that, like, queer people specifically, when they do anal, they're just, like, fucking around with shit everywhere. There's just poo everywhere, and we love it. Now, listen, that is a thing that some people are into, and that's all right. To a degree, don't make yourself sick. Don't go around eating poo. It's gonna make you sick, right? That's a bad idea. Listen, I'm completely inexperienced in that kind of field, so I don't know how to fucking advise people. But it's rare. It's really rare, actually. You know, just fucking dumb, dude. Just so fucking dumb. I've had literally so much anal sex, and maybe had like shit on my dick a couple of times, right? It's just so dumb. He doesn't clean his asshole and assumes nobody else does. This is what it is. It's just like a cishet guy being like, oh, if you fuck around with your asshole, you're gonna get poo on it. It's like, oh my god, dude. No, pun not intended, clean your asshole or shit like that. I know. Anyway. He's just an idiot, man. He's just a fucking idiot. All right, let's see this other Red Panels one. Again, sampling. Okay, this isn't too bad. Again, small sampling red panels is representative of the sort of content of the cartoon, like StoneToss red panels consistently featured extreme right-wing themes like racism, xenophobia, bigotry, and explicit nods to Adolf Hitler. There's this one here where he's like, after being an artist living on welfare didn't work out, I tried pursuing a career in activism and social change. Thankfully, that went better. There you go. Adolf Hitler cartoon there. What's this one? Oh shit, look at this. Look at this. This is like explicit Holocaust celebration. And the 14 words and 88 over there. Alludes to neo-Nazi tropes 1488, 6 million Jews. And the neo-Nazi podcast network, the Right Stuff. There you go. Yeah, so extremely funny, isn't he? Extremely funny. That one is so anti-Semitic as well. I just don't know if I could... There's an anti-Semitic one. And there's another transphobic one. I just can't be bothered to show it, but I want to... Yeah, I want to get into the nitty-gritty of this because I think this is a really good expose. Let's read some more. Every online neo-Nazi these days is out there expected to be paid for their racism, and StoneToss is no different. He's made his cartoon into a cash cow through donations and sales of merchandise related to the comic. Plush toys made in StoneToss's style are sold through his website, and he has solicited payments through crowdsourced donation platforms like the short-lived Nazi-friendly fundraising site Hatreon. On his Hatreon profile page, he wrote, "Sup, my fellow thought criminals, it's Stone, creator of StoneToss Comics here. I'm manufacturing the psychic chemotherapy necessary to cure the world of the mental cancer spread about by the likes of assigned male liberalism and soy-based dieting." These people are so cringe, man. Like, they just have no fucking guts at all, because if they actually said what they think, then people would be like, you are the most disgusting people of all time, right? Can you imagine going home with someone and they have a fucking StoneToss plushie? That would suck so hard. It would suck so hard, honestly. Not only will every dollar you contribute be denied to gay pandering corporations, you are steering the culture away from an estrogen-fueled dystopia where you better bake that homo cake or else. It's so funny, dude. Notably, in addition to the blatant trans and homophobia in that statement, StoneToss uses triple parentheses, an anti-Semitic symbol has been used to highlight the names of individuals thought to be Jews. Excuse me, and the names of organizations thought to be owned by Jews. He also wrote in the statement that donation secures the existence of the comic and a future for brave content. That's the 14 words. Tribute to the murderous neo-Nazi leader David Lane's 14 words. Later, StoneToss established his own donation site, ownlib.com, which links out to Gumroad to solicit donations for himself. So there's a StoneToss plushie. It doesn't even like look like the cartoon character. Omega Cringe Lord. Omega Cringe Lord. Big news! The official StoneToss supporter page is live. Check out rewards and full video here. In 2021, StoneToss launched a line of NFTs. Oh my god, no way did he do NFTs. Non-fungible tokens or digital collectibles, but raised the equivalent of approximately $1.8 million in cryptocurrency before his account was suspended by NFT platforms. Did he lose all his money? Oh, maybe he didn't, but I'm going to go ahead and believe that he did. StoneToss called his NFTs flurks. StoneToss has leveraged accessibility and plausible deniability to spread dangerous right-wing hate and bigotry. Even the billionaire man-child Elon Musk posted on his microblogging platform X, formerly known as Twitter, a modified StoneToss cartoon in which the text in the final panel had been altered. Okay. All right. StoneToss and his cartoons have an inordinate reach and have been boosted by many white supremacist circles, as well as those on the extreme right side of the U.S. political scene. While it is no surprise, racist former Michigan Representative Joshua Scriver also reposted the StoneToss cartoon on Twitter, X. No doubt the creator of StoneToss is very proud to see that his work has caught the attention of so many right-wing asshats. It goes to show how dangerous these admittedly effective and accessible cartoons are in spreading hate and bigotry. Yeah, so here's one about, like, migrants coming through the border coming through the border illegally and then voting, which, you know, literally doesn't fucking happen, dude. Literally just doesn't fucking happen. StoneToss cartoons are not just fun and games, they're also fuel for real world violence. On May 14th, 2022, an 18-year-old man murdered 10 people in a racially motivated attack at Buffalo, New York supermarket in a predominantly black neighborhood. Prior to the attack, the murderer had published a 180-page manifesto which praised other well-known neo-Nazi mass murderers of recent years. Included in the manifesto were cartoons by several of the most prominent white nationalist cartoonists, including one we have reported on previously, Joshua Thayer Legoff, aka Gingerzilla. It's no surprise that StoneToss cartoons also appeared in this mad collection. Another mass murderer who had a fascination with white supremacy killed 8 people at a Dallas, Texas shopping mall on May 8th, 2023. This murderer also shared on social media a modified homophobic StoneToss cartoon. No coincidence that StoneToss cartoons appeared in the digital footprint of both of these killers. StoneToss cartoons, tremendously popular amongst white supremacists, fanned the flames of their violent impulses. Joining the dots, StoneToss was very careful about not exposing his true identity. Despite publishing hundreds of cartoons, there were not many clues about who the cartoonist really was. In one November 11th, 2017 interview with the pseudonymous neo-Nazi Brett Stevens, StoneToss claimed to be the creator of the "This Is Your Home Now" meme and claimed his cartoons were psychic chemotherapy necessary to cure the world of mental cancer, but provided no personally identifiable information. The topic of red planet panels was not addressed in the interview, but noting the obvious similarities with StoneToss, we aim to determine whether or not they were indeed created by the same person, and you already know the answer. Both StoneToss and red panels have made podcast appearances. Through these podcast episodes were difficult to locate. We did locate them nevertheless and carefully compared the voices of the speakers. In one appearance, red panels engaged in insipid debate with the far-right British podcaster Carl Benjamin about the merits of classical liberalism versus anarcho-capitalism. Oh my god! Hang on a minute. This is links to a Guardian website from May 2019. We've seen Carl Benjamin's rank misogyny before. Remember Gamergate? So, it obviously references that in here. That's like a link to a source. Isn't it terrific? That sounds so bad. This debate has been archived on the Internet Archive and is available for listening here. Let's skip to a random bit in this. Oh no, this is probably dangerous, isn't it? Because they might say a slur. I was gonna say, let's skip to a random bit in this debate and see how fucking inane it gets. But yeah, no, we're not gonna do that because they could easily say any number of fucking slurs and that's no good. It's just no good, chat. Okay. You could go and listen to it yourself if you like. There's a clip later in the article. Okay. There are other appearances. The other appearance, it was a guest spot on right-wing racist dumbass Ethan Ralph's podcast Killstream as StoneToss. It's interesting to note this episode did not stay in the Killstream playlist for long. It was up for a short time, but then removed from every platform hosting Ralph's podcast, much to the chagrin of some internet users who wished to hear StoneToss's voice. Despite nearly every other episode of Ralph's podcast remaining available, this particular one was removed, and apparently nowhere to be found. Okay. The stream itself wasn't too extreme. They were talking about news. StoneToss jumped in and started rambling about the Holocaust. Wait, what? Oh, okay, right. So this is incredible. Okay. Every single podcast service silently delisted the episode or straight up removed the file. The stream itself wasn't too extreme. They were talking about news, mostly Avenatti, Obama tweets, and the caravan. Then StoneToss jumped in and started rambling about the Holocaust. According to the comments still online, it was pure cringe and made the guy look like a fanatic. Okay, so here's the thing. Yeah. Nazis were so. And they probably still are quite like this, yeah? Like, if anyone is overtly fascistic in the kind of things that they say, like, they start just doing outright Holocaust revisionism, denying the Holocaust out loud and shit like that. You know, they get slapped down by other Nazis, which is really funny because they're not doing it to be nice to all the victims of the Holocaust. They're doing it to say, no, shh, you're telling our secrets out loud, naughty. Naughty, naughty, naughty. Yeah. And That's apparently why this happened. Excellent evasive maneuvers, Captain Muel. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, number one. Steph, you're my number one on the Starship DJ Muel stream. This is not completely true, of course, since we found that episode. In fact, the Internet Archive already archived it with its rep crawler and is available for listening here. This October 24th, 2018 Killstream episode titled Avenatti Loses, Trump Trolls Obama, StoneToss Live, and Caravan Insanity featured StoneToss as a live guest. In this interview and call-in session, StoneToss spoke about contemporary political affairs from a Texas perspective, a point that will be important later, and addressed a question asking him if he was also the creator of Red Panels. He denied this and laughed at us, but a comparison between the voice in the debate featuring Red Panels' creator and the voice of StoneToss in this interview are the same. Audio samples of each are provided below for comparison.
So what are the sort of philosophical roots of this? Where do you draw your sort of supporting arguments?
I guess it started out with just plain libertarianism and an appreciation for individual rights.
Okay, that's what that one sounds like.
So so I went and looked at it, and I was like, wait a minute, this is the guy who did Red Panels back in the day, was it? And you are, aren't you? Or I'm not mistaken there.
I appreciate the comparison. I'm not going to try to steal a Red Panel thunder.
And then I started asking myself, if I'm going to delineate.
Kind of sounds pretty similar, right, chat? Pretty much exactly the same. Having established the creator of Red Panels and StoneToss were indeed the same person, the father would also be further supported by later findings. We focused our attention on learning more about Red Panels. In February of 2021, the far-right social media platform Gab experienced a data breach, resulting in the exposure of more than 70 gigabytes of Gab data, including user registration emails and hashed passwords. Like many of those on the far right, Red Panels had a presence on Gab. So we consulted the now public data set from the Gab exposure. We learned that at Red Panels' account had been registered with the email hgraebner@something.com. By the way, yeah, for all the right wingers pearl clutching about this, saying that it was doxing, all this fucking blurred shit out here is why it's not actually fucking doxing, you fucking losers. They just identified who he was, yeah? God, imagine a future where right-wingers were complaining about doxing, something that they love quite a lot. Anyway, focused in on the email address, found in many data breaches. Okay, interesting. And then many of the associated emails were tied to cryptocurrency sites. That's pretty funny. was not ready for that. I think I might have just given myself hiccups. I appreciate the comparisons were far more explicit neo-Nazi, but no, I'm not that guy, this idiot, basically. Yeah, no, he was saying, I don't want to steal Red Panels' thunder, right? But he is Red Panels, and he was basically saying that he's a horrific neo-Nazi, and that's cool, actually. One of the usernames for H. Graebner cryptocurrency account Scythe01 also appeared on Reddit. Similar usernames, user Scythe001, user Scythe001. Using a Reddit archive search engine, we found that these Reddit users had a history of frequently posting both Red Panels and StoneToss cartoons. So actually just fucking posting his own shit under a different account. That is cringe, dude. That is cringe. The user Scythe01 frequently posted Red Panels and StoneToss. Additionally, the user claimed to have lost 23 Bitcoin in the infamous 2014 Mt. Gox Bitcoin disaster. Indeed, an email address associated with the other addresses appeared in the Mt. Gox data breach, providing further confirmation this is the same person. Oh, that's so good. That is so good. Oh, I'm so glad he lost 23 Bitcoin. That's so fucking funny, dude. Suffer, you absolute fascist piece of shit. Oh my god. So anyway, the Reddit posts and comments show a particular obsession with circumcision, a theme that carried over in StoneToss and Red Panels cartoons. What the fuck? Scythe001 also stated he had regularly donated to a foreskin regeneration medical firm. What? What? In one deleted but archived post, he explained a little about his preoccupation with the topic, writing, "I am circumcised. The resulting dryness of my glands, penis, the limited range, if, oh my god, of my penile skin to glide, the psychosexual body image dysmorphia makes it difficult to achieve orgasm during coitus and encumbers masturbation." I mean, that is what it's like to be circumcised. I could attest to this as a cut guy. But you know, it's not like it's impossible. Sounds like you know, the dryness. Sounds like my man is a little too scared to use lube, you know? Like, I get it, dude. I get it. Like, it's a little scary. It might make you gay. But it won't. Not any more than touching your own penis doesn't. Anyway, probably a little more info than anyone wanted to know, but it correlates with the obsession over circumcision in both Stone Toss and Red Panels, right? Our conclusion that the creator of Red Panels and Stone Toss is the same person is also supported by the fact that one of the email addresses was used to register a Twitter account with the handle Mr. Roasty. This was revealed in a 2021 scrape of Twitter users who set their email addresses to be publicly located. This Twitter account posted some telling tweets hyping up the Stone Toss cartoon, just posting about his own cartoon. So cringe. Chat, maybe I should do that. Maybe I should make a new Twitter account and post my new videos. Maybe I should do that to promote myself. Yeah. Sick in little sort of parentheses. It's when the spelling errors. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah. There's this little thing that helps with the climaxing. It's called the prostate. That's right. That's right. Not that I would know. I'm not a prostate user, but you know, he could try that, couldn't he? He could try that. Anyway, posted some telling tweets hyping up the Stone Toss cartoon. Creator Red Panels uses Twitter account to support his new cartoon, Stone Toss. Red Panels and Stone Toss were the products of the same creator. Yada yada yada. Hans Kristien Graebner, aka Stone Toss and Red Panels. So. Found the email address associated with a person named Hans Kristien Graebner, born May 9th, 1990 of Spring, Texas. Damn, a year after me. Just absolutely crazy, man. It's just absolutely wild to me that there are people who are like my age and younger who were just like the most loser of fascists. Mental. That's pretty funny that you realized why sick was used to denote spelling errors in quotes. And then you did a spelling error. That's pretty good, Mia. I just leaned sick. That, yeah, literally. That's what it is. That's what you did. Right, okay. Graebner works as a security guard in Texas around the period of 2014 through 2017. Security guards, man. Don't trust them, gang. Don't trust them. Graebner was also found in a 2014 article in New York Magazine that noted an enormous bald man named Hans who had flown from Texas for a party of Gamergate supporters at a New York strip club. In the article, Graebner defended the misogynistic Gamergate harassment campaign by 8chan users. Naturally, accusations of misogyny are thrown around, but as evidenced by the presence of women, of which there are a few. What? In this image? Bro, there are two women in this image. What? It's a diverse group. There's literally two women. What are you talking about? Oh, this is funny as fuck, dude. This is so good. Hey, Husker, what's going on? Welcome in. This article is extremely funny. I won't spoil anything. Yeah, we're going through it, bro. We're going fucking through it right now. By the way. I managed to get rid of the crypto miner that was installed on my computer last night as a result of Trash Bingus. That's right. There's more women than that in my house right now. Right, exactly. What is going on? I literally know 50 times more women than this. One black guy in the back. Super diverse. East Asian guy, you know. Can't believe Stone Toss went DEI and went woke. Can't believe it. You know? Got a wheelchair user and everything. So, you know, he was doing his diversity quota, wasn't he? Oh, by the way, I know it smells crazy in there, chat. I know it smells crazy in there. know it smells crazy in there. More recently, however, we found Graebner employed by IT management company OpenIT at their Houston office since 2017. Graebner was part of an OpenIT delegation to Japan in May 2019, appeared in photos of this on the OpenIT LinkedIn page. Curiously, the same photos of the OpenIT Facebook page were awkwardly cropped to admit Graebner. During the same time, StoneToss was eager to let his fans know he had arrived in Japan, writing on Twitter, "Finally made it to the ethno state, fellas." These fuckers are so cringe, man. So cringe. Attention, if you're a single white woman living in Japan, I know an 8.5-10 tall white man, unemployed as a programmer in the US, who is currently open, but only briefly so, hit the DMs for details. What?! My man is so racist, he won't even... He's just like, yeah, white woman, you gotta be white. In Japan. In Japan. Graebner appeared in the video about the business trip to Japan on the OpenIT YouTube account. Hans Graebner in a video on the OpenIT YouTube company page. Being extremely paranoid about being exposed as the creator of StoneToss and Red Panels, went to great lengths to scrub his personal social media and presence on people data sites, even removing an image of him of his home on Google Maps. In another example, Graebner's absence from a family obituary seemed odd, but a cached copy showed that he'd been deliberately edited out. Public records, however, confirm that he is located in Spring, Texas, and likely works for the same Houston office. This is nuts, dude. This is fucking nuts. Grown-up teenager behavior. This is fucking nuts. Was not listed in a family obituary, but looking an earlier archive capture of the same obituary. Jesus, that's nuts. It's wild. Though Graebner has been openly promoting Nazi ideology, racism, and bigotry online through StoneToss and Red Panels for years, there are indications he has also participated with in-person meetups of neo-Nazi groups. In leaked neo-Nazi chats, StoneToss was cited as a participant in a neo-Nazi gathering termed a pool party on December 11th in McKinney, Texas. Okay. There you go. Got his stones tossed. Despite promoting racism, xenophobia, anti-LGBTQ plus bigotry and Nazi ideology for years through the StoneToss and Red Panels webcomics, and despite his nearly pathological paranoia about being exposed, in the end, Hans Graebner was not as careful as he thought. As it turned out, his real identity was just a stone's toss away, so to speak. A former security guard turned IT guy harboring an obsession with circumcision and racial hatred. Pretty unique, right? My fucking right-wing trans stalker is from Houston. What a fucked area. Yeah, Texas is crazy, man. Texas is crazy. Got some really cool people in Texas. Like the absolute legend, Lucid Fox. You know? I'm not sure if Lucid's still in Texas, but I know that... I know Lucid was in there last time I looked. But anyway. Yeah, we got some cool folks in Texas. It's not all bad, but it's pretty fucked. Former security guard, blah, 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 blah. Created cartoons that reached everyone from casual online white nationalists to killers, politicians, and spoiled billionaires. The question is, how is that going to work out for him now? Great stuff. Fantastic. All right, well, that was really good, chat. What a great read. What an absolutely great read. I really enjoyed that. From absolute quality. Quality. Reporting there. From Sunlight Anti-Fascist Action. Really, really cool. We're going to move on to some other stuff. I'm going to fly through this. My guy grew up a Nazi because he got a botched wing-wang, some say. A fucking botched wing-wang, you know. It's me. I've got a botched wing-wang. Okay, right, we got some more based stuff. Starting the stream with based stuff, gang. So this is from Talia Jane. Cool new Twitter account that I've recently started following. Done a lot of cool stuff. Pro-Palestine. So, anti-genocide activists blocked the entrance of the New York Times distribution center in Queens. If you don't know why they're doing that, well, the New York Times ran a story, the famous... weaponized rape story that Hamas supposedly did on October the 7th that has now come to light was complete bullshit, complete bollocks. absolutely no evidence of it whatsoever that was used to manufacture consent, one of the worst genocides of all time. The New York Times ran that story. The New York Times ran that story, and the person who did that fucking story, Anat Schwartz, who was basically in the fucking IDF. So very cool. Very normal stuff, New York Times. Really cool that, like, the media is just straight up out here being like, hey, here's some manufacturing of consent for genocide. We love imperialism. Fuck the New York Times. So anyway, trucks for the New York Times, Wall Street Journal, and New York Post were blockaded for 3 hours, disrupting AM distribution with zero arrests. This is fantastic. Oh, amazing. They're blocking the fucking road with concrete. Let's go, chat. Let's fucking go. Stop the presses. Consent for genocide is manufactured here. Just blocking the road with all sorts. Oh, this goes so fucking hard. Oh, chat, this is incredible. Ah, this is fucking great. Look at this shit. Now that is worker fucking power, yo. Getting someone with a big truck, get some fucking rocks on there, dump it in the fucking road. Yeah, beep all you want, motherfucker. Beep all you want. Yeah, badass. There's no other word for that. Yeah, see you later, dog. You ain't getting past. Incredible. Absolutely fucking incredible. Will you write about this? That's incredible. That's fucking incredible. Is the article still up? I think so, yeah.
Briefly, would you mind explaining to me what it is that you're doing here?
Yeah, it's right fucking there. I genuinely can't believe it's still up there, chat. That's crazy. Mental. By the way, Anat Schwartz never wrote a fucking article before in her life. Ever. No journalistic credentials whatsoever, this woman. Screams without words how Hamas weaponized sexual violence on October 7th. And they just didn't. A Times investigation by an ex-IDF soldier and Jeffrey Gettleman, who is a known apologist for the IDF. Completely fucked up. So completely fucked up. So there you go. Still up there. Fuck the New York Times. Fuck them. Fuck them to hell.
Outside the, yeah.
So this is like a 7-minute video. What else do we got here? Anything else? Damn, the cops didn't even come. Oh, we got a fucking... We got a Trumper out here, chat. Oh, no, the cops did come. All right. Let's see what the cops are saying. See if they say anything fucking dumb. Hello? Twitter? Knock, knock? Anybody home? Damn, Twitter fucking sucks. Am I going to be waiting for this all day? I just wanted to skim through a video. This man fucking destroyed this website, yo. He destroyed this website. Well, okay, I guess we don't need to see the whole video. It's pretty fucking based. But I gotta say, chat, I'm sorry to say, but I gotta sound the alarm. We gotta sound the alarm. It's fucking Anna Kasparian. Jesus Christ. So this is Anna Kasparian, and if you don't know, on Red Planet we spoke to Benny Carollo, ex the Young Turks reporter, absolutely fantastic streamer. Please go and follow Benny Dog Gay. I'm gonna give her a shout out here on my stream because she's really cool and she deserves it. So we spoke about Anna Kasparian on Red Planet this week a little bit. And this clip is going to specifically annoy me in particular, because Anna Kasparian has decided to talk about housing. Yay! Oh, fucking great.
Bruh.
So, Jesus Christ. I really don't want to listen to this, but we're going
to
do it.
This is what no one wants to talk about, and it's super uncomfortable, but it's the truth, and I'm going to say it. We pay very high taxes in California. We get very little.
Okay. Already, opinion discounted. Yeah? Opinion discounted. We pay very high taxes in California? Oh, shit, dude. Oh, shit. You pay taxes like everybody else. Shut up, man.
Working people in return. The roads, they're just terrible. There's potholes everywhere. There's trash everywhere. The homeless issue and the fact that the city just allows them to hoard, like, literal garbage. And they say, no, 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 it's not garbage, it's their belongings. But I'm sorry, fast food bags from a month ago, those are not belongings.
I hate Anna Kasparian. I genuinely hate her. I agree, Husker. I think she's jealous of, like, Ruben and Dor. I think she's gonna do a whole Why I Left the Left video pretty soon, right?
Literal trash. These are people who have mental health issues, and you're just allowing them to wallow away and die on massive piles of garbage. When there is housing and shelter available, and they're offered the housing and shelter, no is not an answer.
Oh my god, dude. When there is housing and shelter available, dude, the reason that they are on the street is because housing and shelter is not available. Plus, it's a little bit more complex than that, Anna. Actually, homeless people have a variety of issues, including mental health issues that you mentioned, but also addiction problems, also just in terms of money, like where are they getting money from, Anna, to live? You know, a lot of the places where they offer shelter, they have to pay to stay there. You know what I mean? Absolutely fucking insane. She's so insanely fucking privileged. Shut the fuck up. Sat there in a fucking nice fucking studio with a nice fucking turtleneck on. Do you know what I mean? Meanwhile, dickhead here, he was a literal fucking housing activist. I haven't bought any new fucking clothes for myself for like fucking 3 years. Do you know what I mean? Fucking stupid, horrible twat. Yeah, where is that housing and shelter available? Is it as far away from you as possible, right? Right. Hello, buddy. Would you like to say hi? Here he is, chat. Everybody say hi. It's the boy. Tell the people. No. Tell them. He doesn't want to be picked up. He definitely didn't want to be picked up. Anyway, there he is. Hey, Bonbon C3PO. Yeah, I was trying to show you as much boy as possible. He doesn't sleep in his little bed by the desk anymore. So I don't know why. I think he like slept in it and it made a noise or something that he didn't like. He's very, very, very sensitive. So yeah, you'll have to bear with me where I find a new place for him to like hang out while we stream. Anyway, welcome in, Bonbon C3PO and Muhanga. Let's go back to getting mad about Anna Kasparian.
No is not an acceptable answer. You have to take the housing, period. I'm not allowed to do whatever the hell I want to my own property.
Yes, you are. What are you talking about? What are you on about? You just have to get planning permission. Shut up, dude.
I have to take out permits. I need to get permission from the city. I can't just do whatever I want.
Oh, and that's such a faff, isn't it? Oh, it's such a faff to have to get a permit from the city and get permission from the city. Oh, it's such a faff. And these people... They don't have to worry about any of that, do they? They don't have to worry about any of that, do they? God damn it. Fuck you, Anna. Holy fucking shit. Could she be any more unlikable? Imagine renting. it's actually probably not. HOAs do tell you what you can and can't do with your exteriors. You're missing the point, Goblin Hugger. You're missing the fucking point. I don't give a shit about... I literally don't give a shit about any of that compared to, like, what homeless people have to go through. You know what I mean? Hey, Wobbegong, how's it going? Welcome in. You know. Bullshit. Fucking bullshit. Shut the fuck up, Anna. Anyway. Kasparian on housing there. Right, what do we got next? We got some UK Labour stuff. Post from UK Labour. Watch some familiar faces explain why they support Labour's plan to improve access to the arts. So this is a tweet from, I think, literally today. Yeah. Literally today. And apparently this is like a new Labour thing where they're going to improve people's access to the arts. So let's see what this poor bastard, I don't know who he is, this poor bastard has to say about Labour improving people's access to the arts.
I support the Labour Party's ambition when it comes to making the arts accessible to all children.
Y'all hear that, chat? It's a bit quiet. Is that last clip a bit quiet as well? Let's turn it up a bit.
Particularly in regards to their ambitions around the school's curriculum, reintegrating the arts into kids' life.
I support the Labour Party's ambition to allow...
Okay. What the fuck? Dilly! Dilly, what's good? Thank you so much for the £10, dude. Thank you so much for subbing off Twitch. Thank you so much for supporting the stream. Everybody, please. Go and show some love to Diligent Fingers. Oh, I spelled his fucking name wrong. Oh, yeah. Listen.
Listen.
Don't follow that account. You can't because I spelled his name wrong. Yo, hang on. There it is. Diligent Fingers UK. Go show Dilly some love. There he is in the chat. Thank you so much, dude. Thank you so much for stopping by, supporting the stream, subbing off Twitch. Hope you're doing good. No, stay right here and support this man. Do the good work. How you doing, Dilly? We need to hang out, dude. But yeah, thank you so much for stopping by. Really appreciate it. How you doing, mate? Yo, but listen. I just want to talk about this is a video from Labour, yeah? The Labour Party saying, okay, this is about the arts. We're going to improve people's access to the arts. Listen to the audio on this man.
The school's curriculum, reintegrating the arts into kids' life.
Like that, it's like perfect audio, right? What's going on now with Beverly Knight?
I support the Labour Party's ambition to allow all children to pursue...
Did they forget the mic? Did the mic explode? What happened? What happened, dude? How are you supposed to instill confidence in me that you're going to help people access the arts better if you can't even do sound right on a fucking video?
Bruh.
What the fuck? What's going on? Beverly Knight! Fuck!
Their passions in the creative space because I...
What was that?
In the creative space...
Did they drop something? What is fucking going on? I didn't think that this would be, like, so bad, but it is so bad.
Because I was one of those children.
We are seeing too many children shut out.
Different sound on this guy. Literal schools collapsing over there. Is that still happening? Yeah, kinda. Yeah, Britain's very good and normal.
So the opportunity to enjoy creative subjects at school and outside. I support the Labour Party because I support the right of every child to have access to the creative subjects that they can build their lives on.
Yeah, but how long will it take for Keir Starmer to decide that he's not doing this policy anymore? how long is it going to take for Keir Starmer to go, we're not going to do this anymore, I lied, we're adopting the Tory policy of killing one child every month sacrificially to the economy god. You know, like, how long is that going to take?
I've just heard, hopefully, you know, the next prime.
Oh, Jason Manford. No, come on, bro. You know, I never was like a big fan of this guy's comedy. But like, I wouldn't use that to, I guess, attack him politically. But the only reason that I ever like rated this guy is because he's from Manchester and now he's out here selling out for the Labour Party. Fuck off, Jason, man. Fuck off, dude.
Just to say, not only are we going to support the arts, one of the biggest industries in the UK, not only are we going to look after the arts around the country, not just London.
Genocide Keith, bro.
Drama, art, music, and make sure they are...
Kid Starver.
Make sure that they are important for children. And I think
Kid Starver. Let's get Britain's future back. Let's get Britain's future back. Fucking load of shit, man. Can't believe it. Genuinely can't believe it. This was crap. This was garbage. Okay, anyway, next. Next shit. Okay, we got some USA stuff. We got Lauren Boober here. And she's saying some racist shit. So, yeah. Just be ready for this.
We see the threat of the Haitians that are headed towards our southern border. Our military is aware of it. But what is the Biden administration doing about it? I encourage you to go back and look at the hearing that took place yesterday in the Armed Forces Committee with Congressman Matt Gaetz. And he asked some very pointed questions about Haiti and what's going on and the thugs that are trying to come into our country and what our plan is to actually stop that.
Yeah, it's just racism. It's just fucking racism. You know, these fuckers will see what's going on in Haiti, you know, which is like a struggle amongst the working class to actually like get control of their country and reject foreign influence, namely from the United States. And then you have fucking losers like Lauren Boober going on, being like, yeah, they're thugs. And the only reason that she's saying that they're thugs is because it's a black country, innit? Do you know what I mean? Like, that's it. You know what I mean? Like, they have different dog whistles for, you know, Latin American migrants, calling them, like, cartel drug smugglers and shit like that, right? Ugh. Fuck them. Fuck them all. What's Joe Biden gonna do about it? Well, Joe Biden's gonna lean right, isn't he? And capitulate. But actually, accept some right-wing policies about migrants, isn't he? That's actually what happened, because he's a conservative as well. You're all parts of the same machine, aren't you, Boober? Anyway, so talking about Haiti, the US is sending troops to Haiti. Fucking bullshit, but here's a short 100-year history of US intervention, invasions, and coups in the country by Abby Martin. If you're not following Abby Martin on Twitter, you really should. And the Empire Files as well. Really, really, really good content about imperialism and the US military. Let's have a little listen to this. Or not. Thanks, Twitter. Really cool. Okay. Let's try refreshing this. Funny, innit, how you can really easily get Lauren Boober calling people from Haiti thugs. And you wanna take a look at some anti-imperialist, anti-coup content, and Twitter's just like, nah, bro. Nah.
The crown jewel of the French Empire was a center of the slave trade. But in 1791, an unprecedented slave revolution swept the island.
Hell yeah!
The French, and then defeating the Spanish and British empires.
Big up Haiti!
During this war for liberation, America's noble founding fathers jumped into the fray. People like George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, and other slave-owning politicians rushed financial and political support to their
counterparts
in Haiti. Against all empires, the Haitian people were victorious, and in 1804 established the first ever free Black Republic.
Oh yeah.
In those early years of Haitian independence, the United States had barely started to become an empire. In the late 19th and 20th century, after completing the vicious colonization of native land from coast to coast, this baby empire took its first steps as a territorial empire. In 1915, U.S. Marines invaded Haiti. The first act of the invading Marines was to seize all the gold from Haitian banks and transfer it to the National City Bank of New York.
Normal stuff.
All of Haiti's banks were put under the control of American banks. The United States announced that Haiti was now under the rule of a new constitution. A constitution written by Franklin D. Roosevelt, who, of course, was not Haitian. This new constitution allowed the purchase of Haitian land by foreign capitalists, which began immediately.
This is a pattern of imperialism that you can see really easily, by the way. It happens all over the place, and it happens like quite frequently. In my video on Samuel Leeds, I talk about it quite extensively. Not extensively. I don't talk about that in particular extensively, but I talk about how he is engaging in this kind of like neo-colonialism, it's neo-colonialism, like a foreign capitalist investing their money by buying land on another nation's soil. It's real fucked up, and this shit still goes on today, you know.
But with revolution in their blood, the Haitian masses fought back against this new colonial rule.
Hell yeah.
The most famous and beloved leader in the anti-occupation movement was Charlemagne Peralte. So the U.S. Marine Corps hunted down Peralte, executed him, tied his dead body to a door, and paraded
it
through the streets of Haiti for all to see. They had a photographer capture an image of the national hero's mutilated corpse, put it on a leaflet, and dropped thousands of them from airplanes all across the island.
Damn! Have you heard of another country that does weird fucked up shit like that? Does weird fucked up shit like dropping leaflets all over people that they're like colonizing and genociding? I wonder.
American rule of Haiti began with acts of sheer terrorism like this. The U.S. military occupied Haiti and ruled it as an outright colony for 20 years. But colonial rule gave way to neo-colonialism, where the United States installed total puppets, but with rigged elections so they could pretend to be supporters of democracy. But even that was short-lived. In the 1950s and the 30 years that followed, the United States gave up on the veneer of democracy and backed the brutal dictatorship of the Duvalier dynasty. This was total fascist rule. Suspension of elections, suspension of all political rights, no free press, thousands of political prisoners subject to brutal torture, and the use of assassinations and executions against activists and organizers, including massacres of entire villages identified as anti-Duvalier that entire time. The United States supported the dictatorship with aid and protection from U.S. Marines. In exchange, U.S. corporations were able to use Haiti as a sweatshop, with slave-like labor laws and free reign over its resources. Following the end of the U.S.-backed Duvalier dictatorship in 1986, the Haitian people have twice elected left-wing liberation theologian Jean Bertrand Aristide president.
Big up.
The first time was in 1990. But just 8 months after he took office and committed the crimes of things like raising the minimum wage from $1 a day to $2.50 a day.
$2.50 a day. He raised the wage by 150%
a day.
But it was only $1.50.
CIA orchestrated a coup that removed him from power.
Fuck the CIA.
US-backed forces massacred hundreds of unarmed Aristide supporters protesting the regime change operation.
Mental. Well, there you go, chat. A little bit of education about Haiti there. Important. What we got next, finally?
Hello, my old chum.
Thank you for subscribing to my YouTube channel. I really appreciate that. I don't know why that fucking text is so big. America's only real exception is the capacity to do unprecedented violence. Yeah. Horrific. Final thing from the Twitter section, we got this exchange. Perfectly captures the totally deranged hysterical propaganda campaign being waged against TikTok by the US media and political class and the Zionist propaganda. complex. So let's see what's going on here. In case you're not aware, the US is trying to ban TikTok again. They might actually succeed by trying to, I think they're trying to get people to buy it now instead of banning it. They're getting together a big crowdfund of all their billionaire mates to buy the US version. And there's talk of it being the same in the UK as well, which will suck because TikTok has been one of the better social media apps of the last decade of the advent of social media. So, yeah, that'll be sad to see it go. But let's see what Zay Squirrel is talking about here.
Of what nation are you a citizen?
Singapore.
Are you a citizen of any other nation?
No, Senator.
Have you ever applied for Chinese citizenship?
Senator, I serve my nation in Singapore.
I've seen this one before. It's absolutely insane. So this is like a director of TikTok. He's from Singapore. And they just keep asking him if he's fucking Chinese. It's insane.
No, I did not.
Do you have a Singaporean passport?
Yes, and I served my military for two and a half years in Singapore.
Do you have any other passports from any other nations?
No, Senator.
Your wife is an American citizen. Your children are American citizens.
That's correct.
Have you ever applied for American citizenship?
No, not yet.
Okay. Have you ever been a member of...
Like, how can any... This next question is funny as fuck, by the way. I want to replay that because the pause he does is extremely funny as well. Because it sounds like he's reading from, like, the blacklist questioning thing. The hearings that people had to do when they were accused of being in the Communist Party in the 20s and 30s in Hollywood. Anyway, how anyone can, like, look at this and say that the US is just, like, a normal country is insane. Like, how can you think that this is normal shit? Are you from China? No. Are you sure you're not from China? Yes. Have you ever applied for American citizenship? Not yet, but I might do, as is my right. Mental. Absolutely mental. It's so frustrating how all of the privacy concerns about TikTok are legit, but they apply to all social media and apps, but suddenly they have a problem when it's not from the West. It's literally just racism. It's literally just fucking anti-Chinese shit. That's all it is. Yeah, it's not new either. It's just McCarthyism again. It's literally just McCarthyism again. If he said yes to any of this question, what would change? Well, they would see it as a national security threat. Like, I know that you think that, like, that might make them just go, well, he's from China. But these motherfuckers would literally be like, that means that TikTok is a national security threat and we have to ban it. That's what would happen. That's what would change. I bet this poor motherfucker, he's a CEO, so I can't have that much sympathy for him, right? But this motherfucker is getting followed by the CIA without a shadow of a doubt. Like, they're following him to, like, restaurants and all that shit. They're just, like, following every fucking thing that he's doing, every single person who is involved in TikTok. They got these fucking CIA pieces of shit just, like, tailing him everywhere in fucking pizza vans outside their house and shit. Nuts. Fucking nuts.
Have you ever been a member of the Chinese Communist Party?
Senator, I'm Singaporean. No.
Have you ever been associated or affiliated with the Chinese Communist Party?
No, Senator. Again, okay. I'm Singaporean.
Let me ask you some hopefully simple questions. You said earlier, in response to your question, that what happened at Tiananmen Square...
Not even sure it's racism. It's probably just plain greed and capitalism first, only then racism, which doesn't change anything. I know what you're trying to say, and I think I understand what you mean, but, I mean, the way that I see it is that yes, they are motivated by imperialist, capitalist notions first, right? But on top of that, well, with imperialism comes racism, right? With imperialism comes white supremacy. It's all part of the same picture. So I do get what you're saying, but it is still all created. I don't think there's like a first, second, and third. I think it's just all the same in it. You know what I mean?
Where in June of 1989 was a massive protest. Did anything else happen in Tiananmen Square?
Yes, I think it's well documented. There was a massacre.
There was the indiscriminate slaughter of hundreds or thousands of Chinese citizens.
Yeah, but like, isn't that also not true? Yeah, those imperialist capitalist notions are racist as fuck. That's it. Yeah, white supremacy is, it's all part of the same thing. Yeah. Hey, Komradsky, how are you doing? Economic encirclement hits China in the pocket. Western media control of narrative Israel and Gaza won't work. And suppression of the left. Yeah, that's what they're trying to do. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Okay. So that's that. It's just deranged. Absolutely deranged shit. So we got some more stuff alongside this. Some more info. That unhinged maniac freak Tom Cotton just justified his push to censor TikTok with the deranged Zionist propaganda claim it is pushing Hamas propaganda. It's no surprise that TikTok, China's spy app and propaganda tool, is pushing Hamas propaganda. Another reason this toxic app should be banned. No better than meeting with Hamas on the or the Taliban. What the fuck? Some lawmakers have received requests to meet with TikTok CEO and have immediately declined, per sources. No better than meeting with Hamas or the Taliban? This is insane, dude. To be clear, everything Tom Cotton and the rest of the US media and political class say to justify the ban on TikTok is a lie. A cover fabricated by them, the CIA, FBI, Israel Lobby, and Silicon Valley Big Tech, as detailed in the thread below. So, myth. TikTok's parent company ByteDance is Chinese-owned. TikTok's parent company ByteDance was founded by Chinese entrepreneurs, but today roughly 60% of the company is beneficially owned by global institutional investors such as Carlyle Group, General Atlantic, and Susquehanna International Group. An additional 20% of the company is owned by ByteDance employees around the world, including nearly 7,000 Americans. The remaining 20% is owned by the company's founder, who is a private individual and is not part of any state or government entity. Interesting. There's a member of the Chinese government on ByteDance's board of directors. This is not accurate. ByteDance's board of directors is comprised of five individuals, none of whom is part of any government or state entity. Three of the five are American. The board includes Rubo Lang, chairman and CEO, Singapore-based, Arthur Danchik, Susquehanna International Group, US-based, Bill Ford, General Atlantic, US-based, Philip Lafont, Coatue Management, US-based, Neil Shen, Sequoia, Hong Kong based. Four out of five of the board's directors represent ByteDance's investors on the board, and Rubo Lang, ByteDance CEO, represents the company and its employees. Under its 2017 national intelligence law, the Chinese government can compel ByteDance to share American TikTok user data. TikTok Inc., which offers the TikTok app in the United States, is incorporated in California and Delaware and is subject to U.S. laws and regulations governing privacy and data security. Under Project Texas, and all protected U.S. data will be stored exclusively in the U.S. and under the control of the U.S.-led security team. This eliminates the concern that some have shared that TikTok U.S. user data could be subject to Chinese law. Chat, I'm just learning that it's not even Chinese. They weren't lying when they said I'm not immune to propaganda.
Bruh.
It's literally not Chinese. I'm learning this now. But they're just pretending it's Chinese because they just don't like it. This is fucking nuts. This is fucking nuts, dude. This is absolutely nuts. I didn't know any of this, but I also don't care about TikTok at all. Yeah, me neither. Reality isn't that better than myth. TikTok is still owned by billionaires. No. I'm not saying that. You know? I'm just saying that this is wild. Okay, well, there we go. Well, there we fucking go, chat. All right, well. That's the end of the Twitter. The Twitter segment. It's now time for some Jack Saint. I'm very excited to be watching this. I think it's going to be kind of related to my video that I made on my YouTube channel. Chat, I'm going to take this time to remind you that I do this as my job. And while we have hit the donor goal for today, any and all donations are very appreciated. So please consider subbing off Twitch. There you go. There's a link, by the way, to the current vid at the top of the chat. Echo Baz says, can anyone see my post? Yeah, Baz, you've done this before, innit? Like, Just because I don't read your posts in the chat doesn't mean that you're not posting. Sometimes I get a lot of chatters. I do a lot of stuff. It's hard for me to read every single chat message. It's all good, yeah. Don't worry about it. I see you. You're a person. Welcome to the stream. Sorry if I forgot to say hi. I've got ADHD, you know, all this, that, and the other. Please. It's going to be okay. I promise. Don't worry about it. Oh, look, it's the unknown. Shh. Don't spoil it. Right, okay, we're watching. Everybody, please go like, comment, subscribe. Jack Saint, he's a really good guy. But also donate to my Twitch stream. Do both at the same time. It's really good, actually. It's good and healthy for everybody to do. Okay, let's take a look.
No.
Did you know that Amazon Prime recently started hosting AI-generated documentaries?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the ultimate documentary on the Twilight Saga.
Haha, AI bad.
Let me be absolutely clear on something. I was recommended this, but it was my mum's Prime account. I don't even watch documentaries. For me, arguably the worst part of this is that they had the gall to open this AI-generated Twilight documentary with a notice leaning into the fact that they know it's a trash AI product. Like, they couldn't have a lack of self-awareness. They had to turn around and be like, oh, actually, we know it's bad. Ha ha, goofy, funny, silly parody.
This sucks so hard.
We know it's bad. It's not a silly, fun parody. It's the end of the world. Released on Amazon Prime late last year, Eternally Twilight, an AI's Guide to the Twilight Saga, is an hour-long robot documentary that you can purchase for $5, or here in the UK, £8.
Wait, it's not free? Wait, why is it more expensive here? What the fuck is going on?
Which is $10.
So throw on some blue eyeshadow and get ready to howl at the moon.
Now, I've said this before, but quality is subjective, dependent on...
Okay, chat, I have to read you this. I have to fucking read you this. Because this is one of the funniest ever fucking... This just came up as, like, likely ban evader. So no one in the chat can see this message. But this guy just came in the chat and said, "The so-called rapes. Trump did nothing wrong. If that's rape, then I'm a serial rapist because I've also raped once or twice." That's literally what this guy just said. I'm taking a fucking screenshot. That is the most fucking unhinged fucking chat message I've ever seen in my entire life. That wins. That literally fucking wins. Unhinged chat messages of all time. Look, it's there. Absolutely fucking incredible, dude. Chatter comes into my stream and admits that he's a rapist. Well, that's going on TikTok. Yeah, say goodbye to your account, dude. My man's getting reported. Bam! Absolutely incredible. Absolutely fucking incredible. That was wild, dude. That was so fucking wild. I just had to talk about that. Absolutely incredible. Absolutely fucking incredible. There is like a weird... Okay, I want to talk about this real quick, yeah? I want to talk about this real quick because... I've seen someone else say something similar to this on Blue Sky, of all places, the other day. Someone was saying, like, yeah, this is literally just now. Yeah, you won't see it in the chat because like I said, it's a ban evader, obviously, like, you know, and it blocks them from the chat. Nice one, Twitch, for giving us some stuff that we can use for moderation. Anyway, this is something that, like, a guy said on Blue Sky, of all places, like I think a day or so ago. And it's like this new trend where, like, men obviously are just out here being like, well, if what you're saying is rape, then I'm a rapist. And it's like, you know, and people are just talking about, like, you know, they're not talking about, like, you know, sort of like I don't know, what would you call it, like, situations where, like, consent has been, like, misunderstood or, like, miscommunicated or whatever. Like, they're talking about, like, legit violent shit. It's like, oh my god, you know, like coercing people into sex and all this kind of stuff. Fucking hell, man, it's just crazy. Like, men are just out here just being like, so what? I'm a bad guy now. Defense. Yeah. Well, yeah, you are actually. Think about that for a hot minute. That's too big. How do I undo that? You know, think about the fact that you said it out loud. Okay, anyway, listen, we're moving on. We're going back to the video. Streaming is wild, chat. Streaming is absolutely fucking wild sometimes. Okay.
On the tastes and preferences of each individual audience. People talk about things like The Room or the Bob Hoskins Mario movie, and they say, I enjoy this, but only in an ironic way. And I don't think that's strictly true. I think on some level...
Needed to get it off their chest.
You like it. It has...
Also, hey, Cicero Fields, welcome in.
Usually the distinction is more the things that you like about it, you don't really think were deliberate. At the end of the day, artists don't get to dictate how you appreciate something.
Also, I do also want to point this out. Where was this earlier? Where the price came up? Here we go.
Here in the UK,
Right. Chat, which one of these is more expensive? Yeah? Is it the UK one or the US one? Which one of these is more expensive? £8? Yeah? It's double? Like, this is the joke that Jack Saint is making in the video, right? This is the actual joke. I unironically love the OG Super Mario Bros. Movie. I do. I love it as well. I think it's really good, right? It's obviously the UK version is more expensive. Now, you might think, Mule, why are you asking me that? We know that you're bad at maths. Why are you asking me that? Because I also just want to report that the rapist admitter in the chat also said... Because thinking that he was owning me, it's not more expensive, idiot.
Bruh.
I just had to point that out. He also said it's not more expensive when it definitely was. Yeah, the UK price is like $10. It's weird. Right, okay. Rapists don't have very high IQs. This is true. We know this. We're learning this as we go on. Anyway, right, okay. Let's, Where was he? What was he doing? What was he talking about? He was talking about this. Okay, let's crack on.
Each individual audience. People talk about things like The Room or the Bob Hoskins Mario movie, and they say, I enjoy this, but only in an ironic way. And I don't think that's strictly true. I think on some level, you do just like it. It has an appeal to you. And usually the distinction is more the things that you like about it, you don't really think were deliberate. At the end of the day, artists don't get to dictate how you appreciate something. You enjoy the thing, and that's something personal to you. Maybe you don't even enjoy it, but pain and pleasure have become indistinguishable to you, and... In that case, may the Mighty One have mercy on your soul. Tim and Eric, Xavier Renegade Angel, Tails Gets Trolled. Time and again, artists have learned lessons from ironically enjoyable entertainment to create absolute masterpieces.
This isn't the Triforce of Wisdom, but it's something.
I don't think this... is that.
Bella is a shy, awkward high school student who moves...
Muhanga!
This should be more expensive than $10.
Thank you so much, Muhanga. Thank you so much for the £10. Thank you so much for subbing off Twitch. Thank you so much for supporting the stream. Chat, we're so close to £200. Can we get to £200? Tonight? Is that possible? Mental. That would be wild, considering we hit £100 in yesterday's stream. We could also hit another £100 in today's stream. It would only mean 10 people donating £3 each, and I think that's entirely possible. It also means we'll have another unofficial hype train where we watch a cool music video from the 80s together. Could you imagine that?
Bruh.
That would be really good. Anyway, okay, let's continue with the video.
To the rainy town of Forks.
Thank you very much, Mihanga. Thank you for subbing off Twitch. Thank you for supporting the stream.
Mysterious and brooding Edward Cullen.
This, oh, damn, that sucks.
Is worthless. Clearly there was a last-ditch attempt to reframe this as some kind of satire, but I don't think this is even ironically fun beyond maybe the first 10 seconds. You laugh for a minute about some of the mangled AI art.
You love the soundboard? Listen, Great Crab, I'm so sorry. Great Crab, by the way, is one of the VOD Watcher champions. Great Crab has been, like, providing timestamps and shit like that. Oh shit, Catgirl Steph with the 1312! Can we get another dono to make it a hype train? Holy fucking shit. Steph, thank you so much for subbing up Twitch. Thank you so much for supporting the stream. Let's go! Buzzing. Buzzing, buzzing, buzzing. Yeah, Great Crab is one of the VOD watching champions, and the VOD watchers haven't seen the soundboard shit yet because I haven't uploaded any VODs in a long time, and I feel really bad about that. Great Crab says, I haven't provided that many. Yeah, but you provided a lot. And that's more than other people. So there you go. Anyway, AI can only be funny when there's a human guiding the comedy. Yeah, but then it's not AI being funny. It's humans being funny. That doesn't make any sense. Anyway, yeah, we got some cool Edwards over here. AI could potentially be used in some art. It requires a human presence to not just feel vapid, though. Yeah, for sure.
Or the mangled AI script.
But again, like, I have to like specify here, chat. Like, I did a whole video on this, by the way. If you've not seen my fucking video on it, what are you even doing? I can't believe that you have done that and not watched my new video. It's there. Go and check out my YouTube channel. It's on there. It's called What Can We Do About AI? Anyway. It's not AI. It's machine learning. So every single thing, even if it's garbage, bad, vapid, whatever you want to call it, from AI, it's not actually AI. It's just other humans' work that it has, like, devoured and digested and thrown up at the behest of another human who couldn't be asked to do the work. That's literally all it is.
That's it, and there's another 59 minutes of the same AI art while a monotone AI voice reads out the Wikipedia summary of Twilight, repeating itself 5 or 6 times over as it slowly reaches the limits of its search results.
Did input you know in, Twilight out, out, that's what it is.
For its depiction of unhealthy relationship dynamics?
The relationship between Bella and Edward has been criticized for its lack of healthy communication, and the way it idealizes an unhealthy relationship dynamic. The romance in the Twilight saga has been criticized for its unhealthy aspects. This portrayal has been criticized for its harmful message about abusive relationships.
Is that person AI? Is that an AI? Is that a machine learning generated person? I just got tired of putting the quotation marks around AI all the time. Yeah, that's fair enough. Is this an AI person?
Some critics have argued that the series relationship promotes unhealthy relationships.
It is. She's AI. She's really AI generated. That's so weird, chat. I'm not gonna lie. I thought she was real. I'm not gonna lie, chat. I really thought she was real.
Series has also been criticized for its unhealthy aspects.
Did you know that Twilight had murder?
That's fucking scary, man. That's fucking scary shit. Real model in an AI engine? Yeah, could be. To make it more. To make it more believable, quote unquote believable.
Would you like to hear that 5 fucking times in a row? And you know, because it's AI, that if it even comes close to an interesting point, that's because it's ripping directly from an actual human writer who came up with the thoughts. The AI didn't have the thoughts. Robots don't have thoughts. Some robot.
Wait, the EU passed an AI block law yesterday. Whoa, what's this? Wait, what? On Wednesday, Parliament approved a day ago. On Wednesday, Parliament approved the Artificial Intelligence Act that ensures safety and compliance with fundamental rights while boosting innovation. The regulation agreed in negotiations with member states in December 2023 was endorsed by MEPs with 523 votes in favor, 46 against, and 49 abstentions. So what does it mean? safety and compliance. High risk AI, boosting innovation, establishing Europe as a leader in the field. Regulation establishes obligations for AI. Banned applications. New rules ban certain AI applications that threaten citizens' rights, including biometric categorization systems based on sensitive characteristics and untargeted scraping of facial images from the internet or CCTV footage to create facial recognition databases. Oh, cool. Yeah, but this is, like, so fucked, though, right? Because Ursula von der Leyen has okayed so much money to Israel, and Israel are doing this. They're like, they do this all the fucking time. You know? Law enforcement exemptions. Ah, here we go. The use of biometric identification systems, RBI, by law enforcement is prohibited in principle, except in exhaustively listed and narrowly defined situations. Well, they'll make some excuse for Israel to be able to do that with EU-funded produced weapons and shit like that. Okay, well, all right. Okay, well, some good, some bad, you know. EU likes to regulate some stuff, also likes to fund Israel. Fuck 'em all. Anyway.
Racist. I don't trust the robots. Daft Punk were the last good ones. People have criticized my videos in the past for being monotone and repetitive, so that's why I'm trying...
As narrow as the Atlantic Ocean, right?
This video.
That's why I'm trying a lot of different voices in this video.
Wait, you've been messing with my bees. Stay away from my bees.
Also...
That's a good Jason Statham.
Squall. Why are all of the Edwards squall?
The Twilight fandom has inspired a wide range of artistic styles and has led to the creation of some...
Oh, what's going on there?
Works of art.
This film was distributed by Film Hub, a service that allows independent artists to put their work out on various streaming platforms at low or no cost with basically no studio filter. So, in a way, this is democracy.
Film... Though, is that... Oh my god, I am so interested to find out if Film Hub are what the people who made the documentaries that I feature in my video, Entertain Me Productions, used to get their shitty documentaries onto fucking Amazon Prime and shit. It must be. It must be.
Film Hub is not something I was hugely familiar with, and it does seem to serve an obvious need, though I have also seen some artists claim they were not fairly compensated for work distributed through them, so your mileage may vary. It does have a loose content policy that Eternally Twilight seems to barely qualify for, but I'm not a cop. There is, however, also a policy against spreading conspiracy theories, which I guess is the reason the other AI-generated documentaries produced by this YouTube channel were not released on the platform. That's right, I found the channel, despite the fact that the credits on the Amazon Prime page list the standard "I'm too embarrassed to put my name on this" credit. You can just go there and find the Twilight documentary for free if...
Okay. We gotta watch this shit on stream, chat. We gotta watch some of this shit on stream.
If you feel like watching that. You can also check out one of their many multi-part series on occult knowledge and the reptilian agenda.
Reptilian lore proposes their hand in wars and conflicts.
Oh, these fucking AI videos. This is so funny. What is happening?
Global policymaking.
Which, for some reason, don't have the is an AI silly disclaimer at the start. Which I guess means that these ones are meant to be taken at face value.
Some argue that many of...
This is the thing, chat. This is the thing. You know, politics is just going to get stupider and stupider. And AI, machine learning kind of nonsense is gonna enable it, right? Because there's going to be machine learning documentaries out there like this that... They're going to get better and better as the technology develops, and it's going to be indistinguishable. And so, you know, Alex Jones isn't going to need to do like a fucking InfoWars expose documentary thing where he actually like films people and just gets them to say the insane things that he believes. He's just going to be able to like run it through a fucking AI. You know? It's just going to get stupider and stupider and stupider and stupider until it all collapses. That's exactly what's going to happen. And you know what? Like, you got to take some of the entertainment from it. You know, we're going to sit here and we're going to laugh at it as it falls down, I guess. Right? The shit Ouroboros eating itself, yeah. 100%. My God. Yeah, just fucking wild chat. Absolutely wild.
Our political leaders, our captains of industry, and our celebrated figures are either reptilian in disguise...
See the Adrian Dittman thing with Alex Jones? No?
...true purpose hidden beneath layers of power and influence.
I'm not part of the reptilian agenda community, so while I would get the impression that if that's something that really mattered to you, you would care enough to kind of put in your own words rather than just asking an AI to make this garbled version of it. Maybe the important thing is just getting the word out. From the looks of things, this is still a pretty obscure channel that mostly just exists to funnel attention to an indie studio that does write and produce their own original work. I know the grind. I do think it's slimy to use AI to peddle this stuff if it is just for engagement. I do think you should also stop trying to profit off of the work ripped by AI art generators by...
This is going to be the new scam chat. Like, it's definitely already a scam. Already, scammers are out here being like, blah, blah, blah. But there's going to be someone who does this, like, AI shit, and they make AI art, and they get rich from it because people just, like, are going to end up being like, oh, this looks really cool, oh, this art's really cool, and they're not going to be able to tell that it's AI. And someone's going to become, like, not a millionaire. Well, maybe they'll become a millionaire. They'll become pretty wealthy from fucking people over and using AI art, right? And then they'll start doing YouTube channels, and they'll be like, this brand new money-making scheme, it's so easy. I did it. You just have to write books. Like, you know, these people who like, say, oh, you just need to write loads of books and sell them on Amazon. And that's how you get rich. Like, who are they called? The Da Vinci twins? The Mickelson twins? The Mickelson brothers? they're like, write loads of books! Just write loads of books! There'll be people doing that, but using AI to do it, right? The Wonka's Wonderland weirdness from the other week. Well, this video talks about that, right?
Attempting to sell merchandise of your YouTube thumbnails.
But oh, that's insane. That's insane.
This is the second time now on my channel that a random media experience has led me to likely AI-generated online deep state.
Well, you know what it will be? Yeah, the Shawware movie knockoffs won't have what little effort they had anymore. It'll be AI now. Well, this is the thing. It's like, you'll surely be able to tell because it'll just have absolutely no soul. And it'll be incomprehensible, right? A guy came on InfoWars. He sounded exactly like Elon Musk. As far as I know, it's unknown if it's actually Elon or just AI. What? You got like a link to that? You can take a look at that? Like just like a clip or something? Knowing things about art fundamentals makes AI pretty damn obvious. Unfortunately, that's less common knowledge because art isn't profitable to teach in public schools. Yeah, this is the issue, right? An uneducated, unartistic society being conned out of any kind of art. I think it will just inspire people to do better art. I think that that's probably what will come out of AI. It will be like, I don't mean do better art. I don't like to judge people's art in that way. What I mean is like, I think it will like encourage people to make more vastly bizarre art that's more abstract and unique, because then it's just something that's not going to be replicated in AI. But then again, you know, it's difficult to say because it's like I talk about in my video, like a lot of people when you're doing creative stuff, it's like this stream, right? Like if I was genuinely streaming what I would want to stream, I would just be streaming random, weird, shitty video games that no one's ever heard of. Yeah? Because that's what I love the most. That's literally what I love the most. But I do politics because that's what people know me for and that's what gets me money. Yeah? So, and it's like, I am passionate about that, streaming about politics and getting angry at AI and conservatives and all that kind of stuff. But you have the balance, don't you? It's like, what's profitable and what do you want to do? It would be Bingus all day, every day. Not necessarily Bingus, but it would be like pretty similar. I'd just be playing weird, shitty games all the time. Probably some retro games as well. You know, and my YouTube videos would probably be a bit more artistic, even though they are pretty artistic, to say the least. Anyway, I put a lot of effort into my videos. Anyway, listen, I don't want to sound like I'm boasting. Also, welcome to the chat, Danakist. I don't know if I said hi to you. Welcome in. But I think what I'm trying to say is that, like in the video, I was talking about how creatives are like, okay, can I do what I really want to do, or can I do what makes me money? And maybe what will happen is people who are a bit more privileged, well, it still sucks, right? Because people who are a bit more privileged and have more time are going to be able to spend more time on their art and make more abstract things. I think people who are less privileged are going to be able to do that too, but they won't get the the same exposure, unfortunately. It's all still shit. I'm just kind of musing on this, chat. Forgive me for musing. Hey, Willada, when will AI make crappy games we can play here so we can complain about AI while playing bad games at the same time? Half joke. Yeah, good thing that Labour will improve art education in schools. Yeah, right. That'd be really good, wouldn't it? The elderly won't know when they buy a little Jimmy Pokemon, gotta caught them all 14. That'll be pretty funny, though. To be honest. Anyway.
Conspiracy.
Crack on.
They are brainwashing the youngest among us, and they are doing this on the orders of the Chinese government.
China.
They'll be able to, but they'll still be using the starving artist trope. Only now it's worse because AI took the gig work. Yeah, literally, that's true.
In the case of Moon, that was a fairly influential channel with over a million subscribers, not this. Everything you've heard so far is a script I was working on, digging into this particular rabbit hole, and this is pretty much where that rabbit hole ended. Frankly, I don't want to become a channel that just makes whole videos calling out random, obscure creators. I find your theories problematic, and I do not subscribe to them, but I wish you all the best. Also, who even cares about Twilight anymore?
It's true.
Some big channel's gonna come along and make some big 3-hour-long video starting up the discourse about it again. Like, move on, you know? So I told myself I'd just shelve this for now, and if I found a good link on the topic of conspiracy.
Knowledge Fight and the Serfs covered it? Right, okay.
Maybe I'd revisit it again. A day later, there was a Willy Wonka event in Glasgow.
Here we go, chat.
You might be asking, wow, Jack, that's so unfair that you have to pay those extra $5 to enjoy the AI Twilight documentary on UK Amazon. Well, it just so happens I have a tool to solve just that problem. Today's sponsor.
Surfshark ad, let's go. Thank you for clearly notating where your ad starts and ends, Jack. I appreciate that.
Surfshark.deals/JackSaint. Thank you.
People who bought my art lately act like boutique shoppers for buying real art from a real artist. It's also exhausting. I didn't know you were an artist, this dungeon's sub-boss. Are you in the Discord? You should be in the Discord if you're not, and you should share your art there because I love looking at everyone's art. I think it's really cool. dude, you're not buying bespoke stuff, you'd be buying anime titty. Oh well, if it's porn, it might be inappropriate for the Discord, but you could share it with like a spoiler warning thing. Anyway,
heard about the Glasgow Willy Wonka experience?
Dungeon's art is spicy and good. Hell yeah, let's go.
About the Glasgow Willy Wonka experience.
Ha ha, AI bad.
So the basic gist is that since around early December of last year, an event planning company had been hyping up what they called Willy's Chocolate Experience. An enchanting world where dreams come to life, this full immersive experience is designed for families and children, promising a day of pure imagination and wonder. Tickets were £35, which is $45, with AI-generated images and text presented by the company to give a vague impression of the spectacle that awaited attendees.
Chat, if you don't know what this is about, it's so bad. Because here's the thing. Not many boomers, right, or working parents are quite abreast of AI. So they're not particularly, like, clued up about what was going on here, innit? Do you know what I mean? And even after this, I don't think they will be. Because working parents, they got barely any time. You know, it's super difficult to raise a kid nowadays. I know this because I know many parents who are like my age. Yes, it's difficult. It sucks. It's bad. I feel so bad for the kiddos and the actors. Yeah, it sucks. Well, I feel bad for the parents as well because the parents were fucking fleeced, innit? You know what I mean? Everyone got fleeced. So, you know. Anyway, if you don't know about this, strap in, strap on. It's a lot.
And pretty upzeptic twits and chenering entertainment. In the end, the event was actually like this.
Ah, this is so good. Ah, so good.
We got in, there was maybe 20 chairs, something like that. A few tables, a half inflated bouncy castle.
It was that bad, it was funny. They walked in and they were
like, imagine taking your kid to that. Like, you'd be fucking laughing and your kid would be like, Dad, why is this so bad? It'd just be funny.
What is this?
Oh, look, it's a chocolate river.
The company's name? House of Illuminati. The reptiles strike again.
So bad.
Oh, Jesus.
Crocodile God.
Celebrity news. Celebrity news.
Set in a scenic venue in an industrial area of Glasgow, advertised features included visual wonders at every turn, the whimsical performances of the iconic Oompa Loompas, and sweet delicacies and chocolatey wonders, which in this case took the form of a quarter can of lemonade and a single jelly bean per child.
What? This is like something out of fucking Phoenix Nights, man. This is so fucking funny. I can't believe it.
Now, given the fact that the event itself was advertised with misleading AI images, can we also...
You get a jelly bean and a bit of lemonade and you'll be happy with it.
Assume that the blog posts advertising the event were written up by an AI text generator. Yes.
That's all kids need, right? They just need... They're little. You just get one jelly bean, a little bit of lemonade. No probs. Sorted for the day.
Performers were also given up to 15 pages of gibberish AI script, leading to my absolute favourite part of this entire event, the villain of the show.
Yes! Oh, yes.
Oh my God. What is that? It's the unknown.
No.
The unknown. There is a man, we don't know his name. We know him as the unknown. This unknown is an evil chocolate maker who lives in the walls. A human being had to say this to children. I do actually have the script.
Oh, it's so good. It's so fucking good, chat.
That the actors were given.
Ah, Willie McDuff and his band of intrepid explorers. You have something I desire, and with your unwitting aid, it shall be mine. The anti-graffiti gobstopper will no longer clean your worlds. It will turn them to chaos at my command.
A technology intended to benefit people being used to cause pain and misery. One interesting concept. This event was an obvious travesty that wasted a lot of people's time and may have traumatized multiple...
I know exactly what happened to those actors as well. I know exactly what happened because I've been on gigs like this to do videos and shit. Not exactly like this bad. Not this bad, but I've worked in events for a long time. Pretty much my entire 20s, I worked in events. I hosted events... You know, ran events, worked at events, filmed events, did photos at events. I guarantee this was the kind of fucking schmuck shyster who was like, hey, I know you just turned up to do an acting job, but could you help me set up the event space? Could you help me do some of this writing? Could you create some of this stuff and just do all this like extra labor? Probably for the same amount that they got paid to read this garbage script. I just know that that's exactly what went down. Like, and... Oh, it just sucks.
Children. It really can't be overstated how hard the performers involved tried to salvage this thing.
These kids are so scared. It's really funny.
It explicitly tried to disrupt them doing so.
We genuinely did feel so bad for the kids and the parents, and that's why we stayed. We stayed because we felt bad.
Kirsty Patterson and Paul Connell and all of the people that tried to handle this disaster deserve every credit and also money. I regret to inform that the Glasgow Willy Wonka is a groomer.
Wait, what? Willy Wonka, actor from disastrous Glasgow Wonka experience, accused of grooming student from Timey with... Oh my god, chat. Oh my god.
So Willy Wonka is a groomer. Crowds of enraged Glaswegians were summoned.
Is that why you tie your boots us? Because you knew we were all got to kick off?
No,
I'm going to call the police.
For the House of Illuminati guarantees.
The House of Illuminati tells.
Oh, this guy. This fucking guy. Oh my god. Like, you're running an event for children, yeah? You're running an event for children. The first thing that you have to do is make sure that every single person who works that event has a fucking criminal background check, right? I'm not a fan of cops, but at the same time, shit like that is just necessary for shit like this, right? It just really, really is. At least there are reports of, like, fucking people being a pedo. You know what I mean? You can't just, like, hire a random guy to work with kids and not have, like, a CBT check. It's just so insane. It's so insane. I can't believe it, man. I genuinely can't believe it.
Lies.
No. The police were called. All future dates for the event were cancelled. Even now, House of Illuminati director Billy Cole is fighting in the Facebook minefields, apologizing and making sure everyone knows that Richard Bone played no part in this. Which is exactly what Richard Bone would want him to say. As we're making this video, many refunds are still pending, and many outlets are still desperately trying to turn this meme story into something with a coherent message to take away from it. It's me, I'm outlets. Most of them have landed on the misleading
well done,
AI
Jack.
Element of this story.
We support Jack Saint in this stream.
Fell through at the last minute. That
he's doing good work.
Closer to the expectations set by the AI, including a delay in postage that meant they could not receive a special holographic paper.
Cool.
What kind of magic paper was this, Billy? And why was it not worth paying for the next day delivery? It seems abundantly clear that there was no way this event was ever going to remotely match the AI-generated images or AI-generated description. And frankly, it was a bit of an energemic VivView standard to me. But things go deeper than that. See, the story of Billy Cole seems like one we've seen many times before, particularly with the recent popularity of AI generative technology. A man so in over his head that you can't help feel he is surely aware of how deluded.
That's exactly what I was thinking, yeah? That's exactly what I was thinking. You know, you get these fucking losers and they see something like AI and they're like, aha, dollar signs, you know, cha-ching. And they're just so like set on, I'm going to use this. I'm going to make so much dough. It's going to go so fucking hard. You know what I mean? Hell yeah. And then shit actually goes down and they're just completely incompetent. They have no way to fucking deal with it at all.
Deluded he is when it comes to this tech. Much like some other popular YouTubers that have already been covered on the channel, and I'm far too gracious to bring up again. I'm sorry, I can't help it. Shad, what are you doing? What's going on? Shad, I don't think you're as good an artist as your brother, Shad.
We have our strengths and weaknesses, and you know what my strengths are in artistry. What? I'm at a professional standard, and you know that.
Please, Shad. There's still time to accept the duel.
Freaking asshole. I am an artist. He thinks he is better than me.
It's easy to write off Billy Cole's use of AI as just a man stumbling across a website while trying to put out fluff for his blog. It's not even the only deceptive tactic he used to advertise the event. You can go to his blog and plainly see images that he just ripped from Google image search results. Here's a YouTube channel he just ripped a low-res thumbnail from. But Billy's ties to AI actually go much deeper. In fact, Billy has used AI tools to produce and self-publish over 17 books available on Amazon.
He's doing it! He's doing the Mikkelsen twin shit! I knew it! I was right! I fucking knew it! Pre-watched.
That's right, we're back here. His works include Echoes of Illumination, a 300-page novel about a historian uncovering cryptic messages left by a mysterious group in the heart of the Vatican. You might think this sounds somewhat like...
The problem here was not the AI.
Which is interesting because one of the main characters' names
Robert
Langdon.
It was definitely still part of the problem, for sure.
The main character of The Da Vinci Code. Would you believe if I said that Billy Cole publicly cites Dan Brown as an influence? Possibly because he told the AI to generate a novel based on the Dan Brown novel, The Da Vinci Code, and then didn't bother to check that the AI...
So we've got, like, quote-unquote authors now. We've got quote-unquote authors now who are doing the Mikkelsen twins scam, except he isn't paying the AI. Oh, people who do the Mikkelsen twins scam aren't paying their writers either. Like, that's part of the scam, right? So you got people doing the Mikkelsen twins scam, but using AI to write the books, who are like claiming to be authors and then saying, I was inspired by Dan Brown's The Da Vinci Code, but only because he used that as a prompt. Make a book like The Da Vinci Code. I'm inspired by The Da Vinci Code. Nuts. What an absolute horrific timeline we live in.
AI put a character from The Da Vinci Code in the book. His other works include The Hidden Bible. Set against a backdrop of enigmatic symbols and echoes of antiquity, Emily's exploration takes her on a quest that transcends the constraints of history. Guided by the hidden verses, she traverses the landscapes of spirituality,
this
science,
is The Da Vinci Code again.
Uncovering a legacy that could reshape the very foundations of our understanding. The Prophecy Matrix. Guided by prophecies, Amelia finds herself entangled with a secret society known as the Order of
Chronicles. It's just the same book over and over again.
Historical knowledge, the Order becomes her ally in deciphering the prophecies and thwarting a group determined to manipulate the future for nefarious ends. Billy also uses AI to generate conspiracy theories. That's right, we're back here. Operation Inoculation, unveiling the A conspiratorial journey into vaccination truth.
Anti-vaxxer, what the fuck?
Deep state conspiracy. We have reached unfathomable horrors. Operation Inoculation invites you.
So let me get this straight. Hold up. This guy, this fucking scammer who had a pedo, yeah, a fucking pedo, a beast, come and act in his event for children, and he's also an anti-vaxxer. Incredible. Absolutely fucking incredible.
You to confront your own beliefs, question the narratives that surround you, and ultimately consider the power of truth in an ever-changing world. They feed us poison, so we buy their medicine while they suppress... Hang on. At the end of the day, I am bad at making videos quickly, and there's a good chance that by the time I put this out, everyone will already be very much sick of talking about Willy's chocolate experience.
9 a.m. on Monday, let's call that a cut-off.
So what's the point? There's already been some fair takeaways from this situation. You could wrap it all up in the neat bow of AI's false promises. People were sold an exciting prospect, and instead they got a Simpsons reference. Much like with the advent of NFTs, what we're often seeing is laymen who barely even understand the technology rushing in to exploit people even more.
It's exactly what it is. It's exactly what it is.
This is the consequences of that behavior reaching oxygen. So I'm getting used to actually being able to have like distance from the camera. So the duck's been out of the shot. I'm really sorry about that. Ideally, it's a warning that if you see any business openly using AI art or writing as advertising, there's a fair chance you're being sold a cheap scam and should probably back away slowly. I think you should also consider who the people really are that are hiding behind this technology, who are either willfully
Oh, you could tell this guy's AI for sure. AI-generated NFTs equals free money.
Malicious in their use of it, or just indifferent to any ethical concerns beyond what might make them money.
$2, 30-day trial, financially free. How good's that sound?
Again, kind of like...
What's he doing here?
...are hiding behind this technology, who are either willfully malicious in their use of it, or just indifferent to any ethical concerns beyond what might make them money.
$2, 30-day trial, financially free. How good's that sound?
Okay, yeah, so he's doing the whole, like, YouTuber scammer thing. So he's already doing this. He's already doing YouTuber scammer shit, saying that you could be financially free... by giving him $2 a month and you get a 30-day free trial and you can learn to be financially free. So he's doing the book scam thing. He's made himself a YouTube channel. He's part of the pyramid scheme. There you go. It's complete. Pyramid complete, yo.
Again. He is the Illuminati, you know, the pyramid with the eye at the top. Anyway.
Kind of like NFTs. But this is where I keep feeling like I'm going to alienate some of my audience, because I really can't help feeling like NFTs and AI are not really the same. In part,
yeah, they're
because
not.
NFTs have already crashed and burned, and if they do come back, they'll be in a very different form. Going back to Simpsons references, I don't think that AI is the
just needs to start a multi-level marketing cult.
I don't
yeah,
even think it's the
well, the mass- well, that's probably what his like $2 a month thing is about, right? That's probably what it is. It's like, pay me $2 a month, and then I can tell you how to become financially free, and but the advice is literally just to do what he's doing, but again, and charge other people $2 a month. That's literally what it's going to be, right? You know, that's literally what it's going to be, isn't it? It's got to be. If it's not that, then yeah, you're right. He is going to start an MLM, an MLM cult, or he's already part of one, or he's, I don't know. Yeah. Yeah. Where's the fucking hoverboard, yo? 2024. Said $2 a month to Happy Dude, 742 Evergreen Terrace, Springfield. Yeah, it's literally that, right?
Scott Treehouse of Horror episode. I think AI is here to stay. We've been seeing stories like this pop up more and more as companies have been recklessly using AI to produce and market lazily made products and services. We could be talking about...
Well, I mean, I don't know, because, I mean, look, none of us can see the future, right? None of us can see the future, but the way that I feel about AI, right, is that it can only get so good at making a thing. Beyond that, it has no capability of human intuition and creativity, because it's a machine. It's a machine learning program, right? There is no actual AI involved. So, what does that mean? Well, capitalists will probably use it to write films and see what it's good at, like get to the zenith of the technology and see how good it is at like writing films or TV shows or something like that. But they will only ever get to the point of like maybe the most profitable shows that are about, right? So what are the most profitable shows that are about? Probably things like Parks and Rec, Big Bang Theory, Seinfeld, you know, because all of the good stuff always gets canceled, right? All of the actual creative stuff that's interesting and good and pushes the boundaries of your understanding and art, that shit all gets canceled. I was talking about this today. With someone, like, you know, studios just want to make slop. Like, someone was complaining about the new The Crow remake, yeah? And I was like, ah, whatever, it'll come and go. It's like all the other remakes that they made, it'll just be garbage, it'll be uninspired, it won't do anything different, and it'll be annoying and upsetting to fans of the original film, right? At which point, it will get lost to history, and that's the end of it. And that's kind of what I see with AI. It'll get good to a point where it's like, maybe it'll get to write Marvel movies. Do you know what I mean? A decent pulp story writer. I mean, I don't think it'll get to that stage. Often good shit gets made in spite of the system constantly trying to turn it into slop or get rid of it. Yeah, this is what I mean. I think that AI is probably capable of making acceptable slop, right? Because do you remember, in my video, I talk about how that documentary that I'm convinced was made with AI, not entirely AI, but it was definitely, like, AI tools were used to make it quicker or whatever. I think that probably what we'll see in the future, and it'll just be, like, acceptable slop that people put on in the background. You know what I mean? Like a Vorse stream. Yeah? I said it, chat. That's right. I said his name. I'm getting spicy. Right? Anyway, you know, I think that that's probably like the limit of what AI can get to. And so, you know, I'm not certain it is going to get like more and more worse and worse and worse. I think it'll get worse, meaning that a lot of people will lose out on work. I think that that will happen. But I also think conversely that will contribute to the revolutionary optimism that we can all have, in that the working class are going to be like pushed further and further down,
and it will only make them want to rebel, right? It will suck, but it will also birth a resistance out of it, which is already happening because the writer's strike was all about AI stuff. The Studio Actors Guild strike was all about AI as well. You know, it's, I think materially, looking at it materially, I don't think it can ever be like super bad. We'll see what Jack has to say about it because he's probably already way ahead of me. I don't know.
About an obscure wedding planning company, or we could be talking about Disney, who have already started integrating AI into their media. You can't tell me AI didn't play a role in Wish. It's easy to focus down on people like Billy Cole, a person who fundamentally has fairly limited power and will very likely live with the consequences of his decision for some time. A man with financial needs who did a ridiculous thing. I've never hosted a fake Willy Wonka event, but I've certainly done stupid things for money. It's easy for me as a media critic to see the onslaught of absolute trash AI products and poke.
What the fuck is that?
My name is Princess Jane. I would like to show you some tricks. I hope you enjoy it.
Yeah, no thanks.
Even as it slowly becomes more refined over time. But I think sometimes that can be a way...
Yeah, I agree, Gobbs. The amount that this has brought together artists and creative against the thing, it's cool to watch. I agree.
To ignore a deeper existential dread surrounding this whole conversation. Sometimes I feel like when I'm looking at all of this, I'm not looking like a Wonka-like, reckless creative abandon. Sometimes I feel like what I'm really looking at is the unknown.
Incredible.
You know the unknown. Automation is not a new thing. Human labor being replaced with new machine tools is an integral part of human history.
Yep.
You could even argue that the tools themselves, as an expression of us, are a part of humanity. Is there really even a difference between a world of human and robot workers? Right now, yes, pretty clearly, as massive layoffs in a range of industries are leaving thousands of families at massive financial risk, forced to retrain in areas they may still be replaced in for the sake of corporate trends. This is the reservation I've always had about AI art, something I expressed in my last video on the subject, which the robots told me performed very badly, and I should have done a video instead about Nightmare Before Christmas theory.
See, the most important thing for me is that the people making my art can survive. And a piece of technology that allows you to essentially step over them to get to the art that they make seems pretty unavoidably terrible.
Discover the talented illustrator Sarah Anderson. Welcome to a digital realm where art...
What is this? Art, I can't see that. I paused it. Ad openly advertising algorithm trained on stolen work. Oh, Jesus. Artv.ai. Oh, God. Create deep art for free? Fuck this.
Advanced technology, and the barriers to entry have been completely dissolved.
You know the take. AI art and writing relies on the theft of labor from artists and writers, almost universally without their consent, all for the sake of replacing them with trash reproductions of their own work. To that end, the media hot take is absolutely correct. Willy's chocolate experience is a perfect metaphor for the false promises of AI. The Glasgow Oompa Loompa and a screen cap of a broken customer service chatbot may as well be one and the same, and as more technology illiterate companies embrace AI, whole industries will be constantly experiencing their own enchaining moment. Maybe there is just a selfish
for strawberry fields.
There's a world where I too am replaced like so many other professions.
It's important to engage in critical analysis of media and to recognize the ways in which even beloved works of fiction can perpetuate harmful stereotypes and messages.
Maybe in a
what do you mean we're all headed for strawberry fields? I'm not a Beatles fan. Nothing is real.
Twilight.
Are those the lyrics of a Beatles song?
I'm just seeing a kind of dark, sinister reflection, like a Black Mirror. This is like an episode of Black Mirror. There once was a time when it seemed like certain industries would always be safe from automation. But I can't see that anymore. Lawyers are now being replaced with AI. But again...
You wound me. Why? What do you mean? What have I done? What are you talking about?
This is not a new thing. Billy Cole didn't need AI to fool people about this event. YouTubers don't need robots to do bad plagiarism. Companies don't need AI to cut costs by replacing human workers with garbage automation. Not long after I arrived in the UK, a 2000s post office scandal became a massive talking point after a show on the subject became popular. Essentially, the company Fujitsu, which managed accounts of sub-postmasters, used faulty software that created false debts.
Listen to Glass Onion? Isn't that a movie? What are you saying to me?
Thousands of
strawberry fields? I shan't.
To financial ruin. Over 900 sub-postmasters were forced.
The Beatles is so good.
Accused of stealing from their own communities, convicted of various crimes, leading to many broken families and at least 4 suicides.
It's a Beatles song? Well, I certainly won't be listening to that then.
All of this because of...
I already wasn't going to listen to it because the ODD kicked in. And I don't like being told what to do. But it's a Beatles song, which makes it even worse.
Shit technology, poorly implemented, with no...
All right, Muhanga, thanks so much for hanging out. See you later.
Ha ha, AI bad.
Take it easy.
Something that seems so simple. Something that seems so...
Chat help? Don't ask chat for help. They know. They know to agree with me. Glass Onion is pretty good. I haven't even listened to it, and I know it's wrong. Okay, anyway.
Obviously laughable. I have a lot of thoughts.
The only good... Listen. The only good Beatles song is I Am the Walrus, and that is the end of it. That's the end of it.
I really don't want to come across like a doomer who thinks we're inevitably falling into dystopia where everything's slop and reality can't even be trusted anymore.
I know not to tell Mule to do anything. It's true.
Turn to Monk. Like, I can't see the benefits of this future that we seem to be sliding into. This is also something I wrestled with in that last...
Glass Onion is a lot like I Am the Walrus. I don't believe you! I don't believe you! That's a lie! That's a fucking lie! I know it is!
Quality is...
Still not gonna watch it. Knowledge has... Listen to it, whatever. I'm not gonna watch it or listen to it.
...pointed out how surprisingly quickly AI art generation is reaching the point of basic acceptability.
It's showing an understanding of physics and cause and effect. Things that would normally require a game engine, but it's just doing it with visual data. It seems to suggest that the potential of this technology is a little bit more than a lot of us gave it credits. I'm not saying it's going to replace anybody's...
All Beatles songs sound the same? That's correct.
Bruh.
It's the only correct opinion I'm seeing in the chat. 1218 Ruder. 1218 Ruder, welcome back to the stream. Says, thoughts on upcoming Russian election. Much the same thoughts I have about any other election ever in any capitalist country. Why do you ask me that?
Don't go out there into the streets. Don't smash your Roombas. Not stealing your job just yet. But it will.
It's arriving, and we still have time to point and laugh at it all. But we do still live in an economic system built on cost efficiency over humanity. And that leaves a lot of the people this technology is feeding off of in danger. Some people have argued that AI is just the end result.
Hasn't listened to half the songs. All Beatles songs sound the same. Right, listen, get out of town. I've listened to loads of Beatles songs. My dad is a Beatles fanatic. I was forced to fucking sing a Beatles song. 3 Beatles songs at my dad's 60th birthday. I've listened to plenty Beatles. I've listened to plenty fucking Beatles. They all sound the same. It's shit. It's fucking garbage. It's just acceptable slop nonsense. It's like a Marvel movie, but music. Okay, right. I was trying to fucking hold back, but you pushed me to it. You pushed me to it.
Bruh.
Okay.
Result of how human culture has always worked. The individual always being dissolved.
What do you want from me?
Into the collective as we amalgamate the experiences around us. I don't think art is just the result of these great minds springing out of nowhere and producing these great things out of nothing. Everything comes from some material condition. Do you think you just fell out of a coconut tree?
But as long as there is repetition, there is difference. New things happen. Life occurs.
She was so real for that.
This new thing happens. I hope there's a part of our monkey collective that can look past the easy jokes and truly be ready to face the unknown.
The unknown!
Stay away from my bees.
I wanted to give all sides a fair shake as I round out this conversation, so I brought my dog as a representative of the animal kingdom.
Brilliant.
And I've also asked ChatGPT to give their own explanation for the benefits they have to society. As a tool developed by OpenAI, I can offer...
How do I feel about ELO? Nothing at all.
Information retrieval and synthesis, educational assistance, language translation, creative writing support...
Rolling Stones over Beatles? No, I actually think that Rolling Stones all sound the same as well, and they're also acceptable slop. You know. My poor heart. What do you mean? What's up? What? Listen, I just haven't listened to ELO that much. I'm being genuinely honest here. I dislike the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, but I just don't know much ELO. I like Mr. Blue Sky. It's okay, right? It's all right.
Solving accessibility, entertainment, productivity.
Listen, I listen to actual albums made by David Lynch. I listen to like noise music. You don't want to talk music with me. I'm actually a psycho when it comes to music. Like if you heard the music I listen to, you'd be like, "What is wrong with you? Get help." Yeah?
Innovative applications, continuous learning and improvement. It's important to note that while I offer these benefits, ethical use and consideration...
This has been an interesting conversation.
...are crucial aspects of integrating AI technologies...
Thanks for being here, Mia.
Sherlock? Sherlock? Sherlock?
Look at the dog on the screen. This is cute.
Okay. Thank you for watching my video. If you like it, please consider sending me a tip using...
That was really good.
...or signing up for my Patreon, where I put out regular updates Chat. On new projects.
Chat, that was really good. What have I got in my hand, do you ask? It's a laser pointer. No one asked that in the chat. I just thought maybe someone would get excited at the fact that I was doing this. I was spinning it around... And no one knew what it is. It's for the cat. It's for the cat. Because he is an insufferable bellend and will not be tired by any conventional means. So I have to use an actual cat toy and also a laser pointer. And he knows that I'm handling it. He knows the sound. He knows the sound. He can hear this. I've not even like turned it on or anything. It's just just that noise. He knows what it is. He's right there. He's like, Dad's ready to play. I was not wondering, but I'm happy to know it now. That's right. That's right, you are. Chat, I'm so sorry. We didn't get to look at the other video I wanted to watch, which is the James Somerton one by Cavanacle. But we can always watch it next week. It's the end of the streaming week, and oh my god, what a week back it has been. It's only been 2 days, but thank you so much, everybody. Thank you for all the donos. Thank you for all the subs. Thank you for all the support. Thank you just for being here. Thank you for chatting and all that stuff. I know it's been a short stream. It's only been 3 hours, but I gotta go. It's late. I started the stream late. I'm getting back into the swing of things, so please bear with me as that's happening. But I really appreciate everybody being here. We're gonna go ahead and raid someone. Yes, buddy, don't worry. Are you gonna say bye to the chatters? Say bye to the chatters, Tom. Say bye. Yeah, okay, I'll put you down. I gotta stop doing that. He really doesn't like it. Right, okay. Who am I gonna raid? 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 Thanks for tuning in. Thank you and rest up well. Thank you very much, Wobbegong. Let's take a little look. Nighty Night Hound, Mia, thank you so much for being here. By the way, Everybody should go watch Mia Byte streams, because she's amazing. Just saying. You're not following Mia. What's wrong with you? We're going to go and raid David at the 27 Club. He's going to be doing some politics stuff as well. So anything that I've not covered, he's, of course, going to be all over it like a rash. Let's go ahead. Oh, wait. We're not. No. Wrong channel. Wrong channel. It's the 27 Club. Not 27 Club. The 27 Club. Gotta spell it all out like that. There it is. Okay, thank you so much, everybody, for being here. Really appreciate you. Thank you so much for supporting the stream. Thank you so much for hanging out. Thank you for all the donos. Thank you for the follows, etc., etc. Over the weekend, anything stream-wise? No, won't be doing any extra streams or anything like that. That's probably going to be next weekend. Check out my socials if you can't stand a couple of days without me. Don't forget Red Planet. Going to be back on Red Planet on Sunday. Not sure what we're going to be talking about, who we're going to be talking to, but we will be live. That's for certain. If you've been watching this VOD on the VOD channel, please like, comment, share the screen, share the VOD, whatever, however you say it. But yeah, I'll see you all on Monday or Sunday, whenever you're back. Stay excellent to each other. Take care. Peace. Good night. Good night.